Welcome back to another episode of Scenario Podcast. They finally back, y'all. And they finally gonna get this show going. We got the brothers from Commentary with us.
Hey,
what up?
Matt, how you doing? Look, I'm good, New Year's Day.
It is New Year's Day, huh?
New Year's Day, man. 2020. 2020 vision is people saying.
It could be New Year's Day 2050 for all I know. I feel like these last 2 weeks have been like I had a concussion. Like, this had to be how, like, Troy Aikman felt for, like, the last 5 years of his career.
Oh, that's a point taken.
Because, like, no more. So, like, my thing is no more Wednesday holidays. I don't want it. Because it's like I've had 4 weeks in the last 2 weeks. It's the 2 days ahead of it where you're barely doing shit. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, all right, holiday, let's turn up. Then you come back, little bitty weekend, same thing over and over again. I can't do this no more.
Yeah, I'm with you.
No more fucking Wednesday holidays. I'm not celebrating. I'm going to work. Next time there's a holiday on Wednesday.
Yeah, I can feel you on that. Like, I was like, dude, I took a vacation up for no reason. Because it's like,
nobody did anything for the last 2 weeks.
Nobody did anything. Everybody doesn't know what day it is.
I just feel like I've been drunk even when I ain't been drinking.
I've been drinking a lot.
I second that.
You have been drinking a lot.
I've been drinking a lot.
Last weekend, I ran into Daryl at the house set. And I'm pretty sure he didn't realize that we had conversations.
No. I've been talking to you.
What did we talk about?
Not at all.
Okay. I was going to say, what was the context?
But I do remember talking to you, though.
Of what we talked about.
We talked about the show maybe for like 2-3 minutes or something.
Did we?
Yeah, I remember that.
I don't think that was last time we saw each other.
Yeah, we saw at Raven Crib.
People talked to us about the show, but we didn't talk to each other about the show.
Oh, I mean, that's fair enough.
You was fucked up.
Yeah, I was fucked up.
You was drinking that white liquor, wasn't you?
I was drinking light liquor, too.
Man. White liquor is bad.
And I never drink light liquor like that.
I'm a Bombay man myself.
That white liquor.
Yeah, I can't fuck with that
man.
Yeah, Bombay Sapphire. Make you sin. Yeah.
What's your?
That's your shit though, dude. Bombay Sapphire. That's I was introduced to Bombay Sapphire through Rashad.
Yes, and I got it from. Well, I can't say this person's name because he's high in the political world, but you know, I mean,
Barack Obama.
There he is.
Close.
No.
Oh, he's damn near close.
Right.
Joe Biden. You was drinking Bombay Sapphire with Joe Biden. Damn. That's awesome.
A brother named Rashad drinking with Joe Biden. I'm pretty sure.
That's not far-fetched.
Yeah, that seems feasible as hell, right?
And I'm not Muslim, but shout out to the Muslim community. You know what I'm saying? But, yeah. So that just didn't seem like that with Flato, you know?
Yeah.
Bombay is a, boy, gin, just in general. That's a tough.
Yeah, I can't fuck with gin like that.
Yeah, I made some really horrible decisions last time I was on
gin. Gin is my highway to a fight liquor. Everybody's got one where it's like, if we drinking this today, watch my ass.
Right.
Hennessy.
I was going to say Hennessy, though. I could see Hennessy.
I'll say Hennessy is definitely there for me, though. Hennessy and gin.
So if they cut Hennessy off in St. Louis, do you think the murder rate would go down? How many Hennessy-inspired murders?
It could go up, though. There's the other side that it could go up.
Out of frustration?
Yeah, I ain't got no Hennessy.
Cass will start drinking them things you drink. He's over here right now drinking a tequila lime Monaco malt liquor in a can drink.
So what is this? How do you pronounce it?
Glenlivet.
It's delicious.
Yeah.
I may try some Glenlivet on the show.
Yeah, man.
So Glenlivet is delicious.
I was at a wedding. I want to hear about how everybody's New Year's Eve.
Yes. I talked about you last night.
I was at a wedding last night.
I got all your shit third person through focus.
Yeah, it was a hell of a thing. So I was at a wedding last night, and this is one of those things where it's kind of like nothing against the people that are in it. You know what I'm saying? One of them is my fiance's best friend. She's going to be in our wedding. She's dope. I love her. I know she would absolutely knock me out if I ever did anything wrong
right to
Tiffany. So it's good to have that security and know that you have boundaries in your life that I could get whooped by one of her friends because I like that she has that. Right. But I was at her wedding last night, which was a unique experience on several different levels. It was a Tuesday night wedding when you strip away everything. They said they want to get married on New Year's Eve to have it go into the new year or whatever.
Right. Okay.
New relationship, new decade, new year, all of that stuff.
New me.
Go for it. Enjoy it. But so I'm at this wedding on a Tuesday night, mm-hmm. which I know that'll never happen again. I'll never be at another wedding on a Tuesday.
Right.
And they close all the bars in this hotel because people are leaving for New Year's.
Right.
So there's a bar for the wedding, but I didn't want any of that.
Right.
I had a couple beers. I had the wine. I've become a wine snob. So I can't drink bad wine anymore, like regular wine. So, you know, it is what it is. I don't want to call it bad. It just isn't what I drink.
Right.
So I had to go to the liquor store. And I was like, I got to make sure that I'm covered. So I got a bottle of Glenlivet. It was one of them liquor stores where everything is overpriced too. Like, right. Like Johnny Blue was like $2.50. I was like, come on, bro, this does not cost that. You put like a 80% markup on this drink. Yes.
Right.
So I just got a $40 bottle of scotch.
There you go.
And I was like, all right, I'll be good for the rest of the night.
Now. I know this is jumping way ahead of the show, but I think one of the power moves for 2019 was
$40.
$40? $40 power
$40. Yes.
Wait, explain this to me. I want to know.
In 2019, you know, one would say that you could get a lot of thrills for $40.
We just gonna look at me?
Are we gonna jump ahead? We need to let's finish up with our New Year's.
No, but come back. Do not forget the $40.
We're not gonna forget $40.
We're gonna put that right next. We're gonna bookmark that. We're gonna do a full circle on the $40.
And then we're gonna let AI kick that off. But I'm telling you, you ain't heard about that.
I hope
we're gonna talk about $40,
especially cheap twins.
Yeah, $40.
Oh yeah, we definitely come back around to that. So, what was y'all New Year's like? Who want to go next?
Daryl's
been having New Year's Eve for like 3 weeks now. I know. Every night has been New Year's Eve.
Yeah, I was knocked out.
Was you drunk from the 30th?
Yeah,
I was drunk from the 30th. So you just was drunk just randomly on the... Yeah. So, like, how long have you been drunk, like, the last couple of weeks? Like, have you had any moments of, like, sobriety where it broke through briefly?
No, I've been in sobriety. I mean, I've had some days here and there where I've been fine.
But see, like, today, this is the first drink I've had because we're doing the show. Because under no circumstances would I usually be drinking after as much as I drank last night.
Yes, I agree.
But did you have those days, like, where you were, like, kind of, where you weren't drunk? I got some glasses over here. I'll grab something for you. Did you have, like, those, were they all, like, rebound days? Or were they days where you just were, like, straight up sober?
No, I mean, I had some days where I just powered through. I just look at my daughter, like, yo, we just gonna power through this.
What's that about? When you drunk with kids, like, how much of a difference is that when you're drunk, when you're drunk and you gotta look at your kids? You feel like your kids be knowing? Like, they looking at you like...
No, she knows, though. She took advantage of it. Like, no doubt. Can I get some cookies? You be like, yeah, go ahead, because I'm kind of like...
I don't want to have to deal with anything else?
Yeah, I'm kind of hazy. Like, let me go ahead.
Well, I got, you know, my son, 21.
Yeah.
I don't think at 21 he has seen me as a drunkard, you know what I'm saying, or in a drunken state. But definitely, like, 17, 18, 16. And I'm pretty sure I've said some things that... would excite DFS.
That was your prime, bro.
Right.
If we think about it, if he's 21 now, we think back to that time.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure I broke down some classic Snoop songs and may or may not have thrown, you know.
This is what he's really saying here?
Right.
No, okay.
And as example, let's just look at that wasn't possible. You know. Liquor is the truth serum.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, it is.
Even
it
to
is.
Your children, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Children, son, girl, your mom.
Big ass head. Like,
yeah, I try to talk to my bird, my mom's, when I'm drunk like that.
Yeah, no.
She'll guilt trip me. Yeah. She'll want to talk to me about my life. Like, well, how's everything going? Like, what the hell you mean, how's everything going? I don't know.
Right.
Fucking hangover. That's how things is going right now.
Yeah. My partner's had to lay me on my mother's door before I was that drunk.
I threw up on my mom's living room.
Hold on. Stop.
What?
So you were at a house party doing a house party?
Yeah. Nigga, yeah. You would have seen the light.
So you was the one they just dropped, they just hit the doorbell and they just dropped you off?
Yeah. Man, she's going to be sleep on the floor. I don't know if she remember that, though.
Mom's never.
And I ain't even live in a house. I can see if I stayed in the basement.
Damn, you wouldn't even. They just dropped you off at the place. Your last is on residence.
That's top tier petty to be like, just take him to his mama house. Like, I don't even live on that side of town.
Right. Like, well, it was because they was going that way. You know what I'm saying?
What are we gonna do with him?
Right.
We either dropping him off
at his mama house.
it's either the ER or your mama house.
Right.
Yeah, we ain't going to jail tonight.
I never knew how he knew where my mother lived. But moving right along. What did you know?
Okay? That's fair.
Hey, that's a true story.
Let's see. My NYE went down to the Union Station Hotel, kicked it with the noobs for the NYE joint with Manny Fresh.
Sounds fun.
I talked to a couple of your friends while I was down there. Like, man, you talked to Matt today?
That's not a bias.
I was like, yeah, he's not going to make it.
I'll be here in the spring.
Yeah.
Matt's the kind of guy that won't make it, though, a lot of places, though. For, like, anything. Like, Matt is very intrinsic on what he wants to do, though.
I'm like that too, though.
Yeah, like, he be like,
I just feel like I used to see Matt at all the parties, though.
No,
he definitely
no,
used to rock
no, no, no. Yeah. You understand about Matt, though. Matt is very, very like, yo, if this ain't build me up for what I'm fucking gonna do, then I'm not, I don't have to be there.
Right.
That's fair.
That's what, fair. And he don't let
me know. I do have a funny Matt story. I don't know if I can say it on this.
Sure, why not?
Is this pre, pre,
yeah, which version?
Oh, this was Thug Matt. Oh, like, this one I had to play like Michael year, Jackson off of Beat It and step in between him and somebody else.
Oh, that was 2 years ago.
That was a misunderstanding.
Yeah. Oh, this ain't that long ago.
Yeah, I called it. That was 2 years
ago. And I think, you know, like, I got love for both people, but I think the other person recognized that, you know, Matt wasn't bland. And it was just like, come on, guys, we just gotta.
I had a white shirt on, yo.
He did.
He remembers.
I had a white shirt on.
Hey, I guarantee, not even being funny, because I like to look at myself as light brown, but people say I'm light skinned. If a light skinned person wears a white tee, you probably gonna get your ass. Wow, I'm serious.
That logic might be.
I can prove this by stats.
Well, I'm gonna do a power rank in the top 10 light skinned dudes that have worn white tees. I'll get that out.
We need to find some YouTube videos.
Damn, that's a good topic.
We will.
The top 10 light-skinned dudes. Period.
I'm going to do a light-skinned people power ranking.
That's what I'm saying, in general. I mean, Malcolm X is going to be very...
Well, I'm not going to go that far.
Is Malcolm X light-skinned? We have to determine what light-skinned is now. Light-skinned. He's light-skinned.
He's got red hair, too.
You know who's an underrated light-skinned dude?
Ooh.
O'Brien.
The singer. The
singer. Hold on. Oh, no.
You and I.
You talking about going back...
So in the history of light-skinned folks, this is a little bit of a tangent, but I feel like I got to stand up for the people that I am. Okay. The early 90s did light-skinned people a disservice, because there was a lot of light-skinned dudes that was out there singing real hard into the camera.
It was really the 80s.
It was a flip
over. It was the 90s, too.
The 90s really
was
sealed
the really
it.
Was
well, Christopher Williams, you know.
The New Jack City. That was the end of his New Jack City.
Yeah.
But the 80s, light-skinned dudes was really getting over in the 80s.
Eric Benet was singing pretty hard.
We was
femininity.
But light-skinned dudes.
You name it, one light-skinned dude. I can name 10 other dark-skinned dudes that were singers at the same time.
I still think that dark-skinned people are angry that Michael Jackson signed with us in 85. I think that's where the problem came.
You know, that's the first clone story I heard, that was like a
Michael
Jackson
clone.
Oh, man,
hold on. Stop
from
that.
The Pepsi commercial.
Stop that.
All right. Riley, and you're okay with his... lifestyle.
Well, I mean, I know he ain't no real gangster, but that's cool. Because, see, he's in entertainment. He ain't got to be out in the streets like I do. He's telling our stories for us.
So you're okay with him being gay?
Gay? Who said he was gay? Nigga, is you crazy? Gangstalicious gay. You crazy.
Come on, Riley. The song, the dance, I mean, do the homie.
The homie dance ain't gay. I do the homie.
That's not gay. You who thinks everything in the world is gay?
Nigga, you gay. You gay. Y'all niggas are gay. Nigga, you gay.
That's gay. Don't find any of this gay at all.
Okay, so all that other stuff was gay. But Gangstalicious ain't gay. You can't just go throwing that gay thing around, Huey. That's a serious accusation.
You the one who said he kissed another man.
What I had said was
that... All right, cool.
Okay. Yeah, that was... Anyway, I just heard that, you know, the Michael Jackson that got burned on the Pepsi commercial set was replaced by the light-skinned Michael Jackson, who would reappear singing Bad. That's what I heard.
Yo,
is that one worse or the Paul McCartney one?
Paul McCartney's stupid.
Yeah.
The dude that is him is another dude.
Yeah, they say Paul died in a car accident.
They said it has got another dude that can sing.
They said Paul McCartney died in a car accident in 65, and then every Beatles album after that was a different guy.
That's been a long time conspiracy.
Paul is dead.
Kind of the Mandela effect thing, where people thought Mandela was deceased.
So you're saying, is this Michael Jackson of official clones? Is another dude that, is it like the Paul McCartney thing? Was a dude that kind of looked like
that? Probably was like the Paul McCartney situation. You know.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's what I heard. I don't know.
So they say he died in the Pepsi commercial.
Well, that he was burned real bad or whatever, and they was just like that he couldn't be the same Michael.
He turned into my man off Atlanta.
That was a very disturbing episode.
So you saying that Michael Jackson is maybe still alive? The real Michael Jackson is still alive? In theory,
there's a chance. But they said that Michael was so cold and like just disguising himself. They say he would be in like public all the time.
Yeah, they said he would. He would get prosthetics and everything just to go hang out.
Yes, sir.
It was like Batman.
No, yeah. Wow. Like, because he was cool with the dude that did Thriller. Is like the same dude did like E.T., a couple other different things, and he would just come by the crib and be like, yo, I want to go out for like a day. can you just hook me up and make him look like a different person?
Now, on the Simpsons episode where it was like the Lisa, it's your birthday, they said that really was Michael Jackson.
Really?
Like, he was the voice of the character. And they said it was based off of one of the suits or the outfits that Michael Jackson would wear and go out in as like a fat white man.
What?
Wow.
Research it. See, the Simpsons is already on some crazy shit, period.
I agree.
So, I don't know. It's like that. I think Matt Groening, is that his name?
Yeah,
Matt
Groening. Yeah, he's in the Matt gang.
Yeah, I think they'd be on to something.
Well, damn.
With this stuff.
Well, yeah, how was your New Year's?
Was
our party good? It looked like it was.
It was a cool time, man. I got pretty hammered, so
yeah.
I was standing on the speaker hosting the rest of the night after Manny got off. So
fucking awesome.
What was your?
How long was Manny off?
Manny was off about an hour 25 maybe.
Damn,
that's good. That's good.
About an hour 15, hour 20.
This gave me two.
Prices, bro.
No, that's the kind of DJ I'm trying to be. So
yeah, but I would always think that I thought like headline DJs give you at least two though.
Nah, usually one. Like Badu, she charges like $10,000 for an hour.
Shit,
that's about what he's charging too.
Yeah.
Damn, $10,000 for an hour?
Yeah, man.
Good hours work. I mean, if you created the most important song of the last 20 years,
no, I get it. But
the most important song of the last 20 years is. Back Manny Fresh, without a doubt. It's become a wedding song for our generation.
It's a Negro spirit.
Chord, triton, violin sound.
Yeah, I mean, we had a conversation last night at the second, well, I can't really call it wedding, a New Year's Eve party. For the New Year's Eve party, I got to it about 1 o'clock.
There you go.
And it was one of the best songs of all time that you immediately know. That's that song.
Back it up.
In the first five seconds when it come on, you just like, dang.
Best 17 seconds ever.
When Back That Ass Up starts, it changes the whole mood, and I would argue the temperature of the room.
It does.
There's still Gene shit burned into the walls of my college house from that song. I'm sure they couldn't paint over it. The grinding was so strong, there's just a blue strip about 5 feet, 8 inches off the ground.
It's probably a... YKK impression on my dick.
YKK.
From just like grinding. From back in the day.
I'm proud to be a part of the grind generation.
So I go by the name of Rashad Isner. Say, we are Commentary Intellectual Black Versation coming soon. Yeah.
Good. Absolutely.
Perfect way to plug that shit. Plug in. He said that.
Let's go back to his old.
That's called an audio clip.
Right.
I'm about to put that out as a
Don't let my mom a
promo.
The joint was I was pretty hammered, man. So we
how'd you get there? What was your
I Ubered.
What was no not that? How was your journey with the drink?
Me and my lady started on Tito's and Club at the crib.
See, that was my downfall.
Well, my lady doesn't drink dark, so unless good it's wine.
Because a woman that drinks Hennessy, definitely questionable.
No. She gonna punch you at some point.
I love women that can drink. I love women drink Crown though.
She gonna punch you in the.
Oh, yo, most sisters drink Crown.
No, I love a woman that can drink Crown and know
the Crown Apple. Or now it's like new apple.
No, I'm talking a nice. Oh, not even as a Crown. That's a nice whiskey. You know what I'm saying?
I put some of that Glenlivet up for my lady last night, and she was looking at it like I just gave her an invoice. I don't ever give me this again in my life.
I got on a Glenlivet when I was out in Cali. Like Cali cats really be on a Glenlivet.
Because they're promoting a lot online though too, and doing a lot with podcasts though too.
I drink Johnny, I drink Glenlivet, I drink sometimes I drink Oban, been drinking Balvenie, like different stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
All in all, I had a great night.
Good, man.
So do we want to do our topics or we going to our awards?
Do we have emails?
No, we don't have any emails.
Did we pocket one?
No, we didn't pocket any. It was Christmas.
Oh, that's right. We used it. We went ahead.
You didn't ask me about my New Year.
I thought you talked about it before.
Yeah, I thought you talked about it before. Yeah.
I ain't do shit. Nah, I was hanging out with AI. Shout out to, seriously though. Shout out to AI. Shout out to Manny Fresh. Cool dude. Shout out to Jam Master Jason.
So is Jam Master Jason? Lil J, what up?
The
Does he roll with?
I think
me?
He. Yeah. Like, so shout out to the legendary Chief, DJ Charlie Chan.
Yes, you know.
So
after,
is he cool with Chan?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, that makes sense. You know, Jay. Well, yeah. Not Jay. You know, Charlie and Jay were like tight.
Yeah, so, yeah, because Charlie took over unofficially for Jay.
Yeah, and they were like little oaks. You know, Charlie been around Run DMC since the 80s, man. Like he roadied for them for years before he even started. I'm for lack of better choice, where he's gotten the position he's in now. He just kind of roadied for him, open shows, did a lot of venues, and then the opportunity came along. You know, unfortunate in a lot of aspects, but the opportunity came along for him, and you know, he capitalized on it and made it do what it do. So that's my guy, man. I'm proud of him.
Damn right.
Charlie a real legend, man.
Charlie's a full-on legend. Ain't no mistaking about that. He's a full-on legend.
Yeah, we've been real, man. I wouldn't be in a lot of positions I'm in if it weren't for Chan, man. So, you know, shout out, for real.
Much respect.
Yeah. So how was this decade's New Year's Eve different from the last decade's New Year's Eve for everybody? If you can call back.
That's a really solid question.
If you can call back.
I can tell you for sure that I had just had a son, so... I was, let's see, so New Year's Eve 2010.
So your son is 9?
My son's 10 now.
10, okay.
Born 09. So New Year's Eve 2010, I was actually in the emergency room after I got done hosting a joint at the Forest Park Golf House. My son fell at the crib out the bed and hit his nose.
Oh.
So I rushed from there and went to the emergency room. He was good, but you know. Yeah, yeah, at the golf house.
Yeah, that was my party. Yeah, that was my party in 2010.
Yeah.
That was my party.
It was me and DJ OK.
Yep.
What's up with OK, man?
Yeah.
He's doing well. He's all right, man. He's working. All right,
good. That sounds good. Said.
I'll talk to you afterwards.
I don't remember 2010 at all. I don't know.
No, man, you have some dark years, though, when you talk about that. You don't even
some.
Know. You know, Matt has years that he doesn't remember at all that happened to him in his life.
Yeah, they just, I feel like the same thing now. 2010 was, where was I living? Was I living here yet? I think I was living here. Yeah, I don't remember. I have no clue.
That happens the older you get, man. It all just starts to blend.
No, we were talking about that earlier. Yeah, they all blend together.
I think at 2010, I do remember that I was like, man, I ain't gonna never get off of child support. In August of 2019... was my last child support payment. I want to give a pause to that. You know,
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I still love my son and the money. We'll never get funny for him, but this ain't going through your motherfucking mind. Yeah. So anyway.
That's called upward mobility, right?
Right. They take them damn shackles off of you.
He's still in college, so it ain't. It's still.
Shout out to Mary Mary. I want to praise you. Take them shackles off my feet before I can dance.
Last night.
Can I say this real quick?
Yeah.
When we talk about decades, now, Matt, I know you are a very, very brilliant man. You have the memory of an elephant.
It's starting to wither some.
Starting to wither?
It's still solid.
So, was it back, was it within this past decade that, like, if you was trying to get some ass listening to the radio, it would be like a slow song and then a church song? Or was that, like, prior to 2010?
That was 2000.
That's early 2000.
Okay. That's 2000s. Okay. Oh, that's the 2000s.
Okay. This is the decade where cats started cussing the chicks on their songs.
Yeah, that's true. Cats.
That's one of the great legacies of the 2010s, where you have cats doing features and they just like, I'm going to take this bitch back to the crib. You're like, hold on, man. Because
before then, it was like, no more late night creeps.
Cats was apologizing in the 2000s.
Yeah.
And then their sons came out the next decade. Right. And it's just like, we don't give a fuck.
Yeah, I don't want to hear my dad singing that soft shit.
We got social media, man. We don't care. We're going to portray ourselves how we want to.
Yeah, we need to find out who Jacquees' father is.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. All that shit's R. Kelly's fault, man.
Maybe Jaheim.
R. Kelly's the best thing. No, R. Kelly's the best thing and the worst thing that ever happened on R&B.
Who?
R. Kelly.
Robert.
The best and the worst.
That's definitely.
Where y'all at with R. Kelly, man? Can you rotate R. Kelly into
I haven't been really listening to him, man. Like, it's only like maybe two or three songs I can straight listen to, man.
So, like, if R. Kelly comes on, I'd ask you this. So, this is great.
Yeah,
so, we get to a key part of next May's event. Because I DJ in my wedding.
So
when we get to
you gotta let me come. I need an invite.
You're gonna be lit, bro.
You're definitely there.
All right.
But when we get to them key parts of the night, when you're doing the mix now, you're just like, oh, it's time to go. Oh shit.
Yeah.
This is where I would go to pull that R. Kelly. But can I do it with this crowd?
Cause nobody played, dude.
Nobody.
My bad, AI. That's you're good, on you, brother. Go ahead.
No. So R. Kelly's like a weird space, right? Because for the first time in 2019, I started getting no R. Kelly requests. Like, mm-hmm. this is my wedding. I don't want no R. Kelly. And then some people was like, hey, look, to hell with everybody. I don't care who, like, if it's my joint, you're going to play some R. Kelly because that's what we get down
to. So people were like, so it was a backlash year. This 2019 was a backlash year?
Yeah. On a personal level. Yeah. You know, and people will say, you can go either way on this. For me with R. Kelly, because it varies from person to person, I can still play his music and separate it from the fact that he was a trash individual with young women. You know what I'm saying? Me personally, I can.
Yeah.
But then it's probably other people I would be like, hey, you know, like, bro, I can't get down with that. R. Kelly's just not one of those people. Maybe had it been a relative, friend, you know, sibling, something like that, I'd be like, hey, bro, like, and that's not to, you know, deflect from anyone's pain. Mm-hmm. Just where I am with him personally is just there. So I can't really, and I don't bang it often. Like, St. Patty's Day this year.
Mm-hmm.
And we were down in Dogtown. I had opened up a little joint down there over at Felix's, the pizza spot.
Okay.
And the guy that came on after me, like, literally, first song, Ricky, Ricky, girl, man, girl. No, I ain't trying to be. And everybody's like, white. Oh! And black people was like, turn that shit off.
It was ignition, right? White people love ignition.
Yes.
Bruh.
No. That is one of the top songs that white people love the most.
Either that or Flow Rider.
So no. I'm talking about there is other, like, it's that, what's the other song? I put my hand on your hip. We need to.
You talking about songs that the top songs that white people have taken
from black people.
Kidnapped
yes.
for themselves.
Yeah.
This is how we do it.
I think we might got that. We got that back though. I think we have retroactively got that back.
I think Dirty Mugs might have kept that kind of still on the side for the Caucasians.
I mean, that's in a certain sector of the community. I think in general, they have let white people let that go though. They moved on to ignition.
Yeah. Yo, can I make a comment about R. Kelly though?
Do it.
I think it's fucked up, man. So all of this is serious, even though mm-hmm. some of this Absolutely. May sound goofy. I think as black people, we have to make some serious decisions, man. We mm-hmm. gotta make our mind up, like, for real. Because it's not like, so I just want to make three quick points. Number one, it's not like people didn't know that R. Kelly was, you know,
True.
Behaving a certain way mm-hmm. way before it got to the Lifetime channel or whatever whatever it came on. So that was one problem I always had. People were still Ignition, Fiesta, and Stepping in the Name of Love and all this stuff. And a lot of people even was kicking it with R. Kelly when he was in St. Louis. Yeah, I think this was a couple years ago when that concert happened.
No, he had a concert this year, didn't he?
Was it this year?
Yeah, at St. Charles Arena.
It was at St. Charles Arena.
Yeah.
Oh, people were still there.
No, it was last year.
Was it last year?
2018.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, but people were still there, and all these allegations and actual factuals, you know what I'm saying? Another thing, too, we got to think about the children. Now, we are about to have a generation of kids who are getting ready to be doing some really, really crazy shit because once upon a time, they believed that they could fly. And now, because R. Kelly is R. Kelly, they're like, just, hey, I'm not shit, but just, I guess, urine prone? I mean, I don't know what this term is. I don't know what this term is. You're killing the kids.
That's not going to go over well.
Do as I say, not as I do. Maybe that is the card that can save R. Kelly.
You think R. Kelly going to come back?
R. Kelly's done.
I think R. Kelly is souffle. You know what I'm saying?
He's going to do some time, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is he gonna stay this time? Because it seems like he be breaking out of jail like a Batman.
People sent him a gang of commissary. Did you hear that?
He goes to jail and gets out, and it's just
he's been in for a while.
It's like, damn, why did it always feel like he's coming in, getting back out, making a plea, getting back out? Like, he already got a hole dug in the back of the jail already or something.
Like, you said he's crawling out then.
Yeah, he's like a Batman villain.
Yeah.
He never quite seems like he goes away.
Yeah, I think his career is over.
Yeah, absolutely. Career's definitely over.
He maybe can. You know what? He needs to kill himself too.
Oh, well,
God damn!
No. I told Bill.
Oh,
I
he's said, got a theory that people need to leave.
Yeah, like I said, Bill Cosby should have died earlier too. Like Bill Cosby, if he'd have died right when everything was going on, even if he had to fake his death, he probably had enough money to fake his death. If he'd have faked his death, all this stuff would have never come out.
I bet you the Cosby Show would still be on air.
Exactly.
I do.
So she'd have died.
Yeah.
And it had been all good for your legacy. Now your legacy is all fucked up.
Because the women remembered you tickled their asshole with a wet thumb.
Look here, man.
In 1963.
No. I will. Look. Now, I will disagree with you with that. That dude was real egregious with his asshole tickling.
Okay.
He thought it was still the 70s.
So, wait. So, I want to get my timeline right here. So, on New Year's 1980, that shit went out.
No, I'm not.
No more Spanish fly ass tickling.
Right. My whole point is it's egregious period in general. I will give you a pass for a certain extent, though. Now, I want to give you a pass. I will say that, if you want to say that was the times you was in, y'all was doing that, I'll give you that. Maybe.
Well,
but then he was continuing on through the modern era.
Shout out and definitely rest in peace to our brother John Witherspoon, Pops. I got a chance to meet him, and he was talking about Bill Cosby and stuff, and he was honest. He was like, "Hey, at the Playboy Club and shit back in the 70s,
he was doing coke and doing all kind of shit,
chasing with a Quaalude, you know what I'm saying, or whatever. You have a drink and things happen. I'm the one who's saying asshole. He looked like he would, kick through the ass, he looked like he would be on some shit like that, but no pun intended. But it's just, I'm just trying to, this is tricky, but the statute of ass tickling.
But no, he was doing shit in the 2010s, thinking it was still all good.
But wasn't it like they was down for the get down, or?
It don't matter if you put somebody in some woman drink, even if they down.
Now, I agree.
So this is the thing. I'm going to give you a good comparison. What was the dude from the Green Bay that got locked up for raping women and putting some of their drink
on?
Darren Sharper.
Okay.
He was already an attractive dude. Women already liked him, but he just liked his women being dead fish.
Okay.
They was going to give it up regardless.
Shit, go get a motherfucking hold it.
No, strip it. He don't want.
Do some shifts at bottoms up.
But that's a demented idea, I want him to be this.
Yeah, that is like some psychosomatic shit.
That's what I'm saying. Maybe these women probably, you could say these women may have been giving up or not, but he wanted it a different way, though.
Now, I'm in no shape, form, or fashion saying that you should ever drug a woman by putting things in her drinks, buying purses and shit like that. All I'm saying is, at some point, I don't know. That whole Bill Cosby shit just seems weird to me.
It's a lot of women, man.
Yeah, and then what he ended up
continued for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, dude, it does was like come the off worst. As a greasy guy. You know what
it
I'm saying?
It was like the worst inside knowledge.
He wasn't a good person. Yeah. The most black
That's
true.
He went in on black people though hard.
Now. So Bill Cosby fucked up with that. You know what I'm saying?
The pancake speech, man. Come on, man.
Yeah. Nah, I remember that. But my whole thing is, I guess, and I know this may be cliche to some, but I guess it's, what do they say? What's good for the goose is good for the gander?
Yeah, but I don't agree with that.
Okay. So Harvey Weinstein and them,
still got a criminal case on him.
$25 million.
He still got a criminal case.
Hey,
it's still a criminal case on him.
He ain't breathing cell block air.
But it's still a criminal case right now. That case with Bill was from 2010, 2011. But I'm saying Harvey Weinstein still has a criminal case.
Wasn't it with Bill Cosby that the case was actually closed? But it was like a judge who was like, "No, I'm opening it back up."
I mean,
Harvey Weinstein too, though. They had to reopen the case on him too, though.
Yeah, but I thought Bill Cosby, with the sister that ended up going down, he ended up, didn't they have a settling out, and he still got locked up?
No paper on that.
I could have sworn.
No. Okay. He settled some other shit.
I thought
there's money everywhere.
Yeah. Harvey Weinstein shit got reopened.
It's a whole lot of backtracking going on either way it goes.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But my whole point is, us as black people, we can't want freedom just when it's convenient.
Yes, I agree.
I agree.
And that was kind of a point I was making early. I know this is a very tricky subject, and said something that'll get us all lit up on Twitter. I don't give a damn.
Yeah.
But that's what I'm saying. With black people as a collective, we have to start making our minds up. And I agree with you. It can't be, it's good here and it's not good there.
We're going to be a moral compass for, and people will be like, "Oh, well, they doing it." No. Our moral compass should be better than any other motherfucker, though, because we need to regulate ourselves.
I agree. Mm-hmm. I agree. But
so
my
those
whole
women
thing,
getting raped, though, in those situations, though, we need to be on top of that in general as ourselves. Right. We shouldn't care that white people doing this.
No, that's what I'm saying.
But that's
I know that's cliche.
A lot of people have that agenda, though.
Right. Yeah. I know that's cliche to say, it's something that I still do pay attention to, but I don't pay. So let me make it clear for myself. I'm not paying attention to it in the sense of, oh, they doing that, so we should do that. And you know I ain't that type of guy.
Yeah, no, but there's a lot of cats that be on this
shit. No, that's true. Yeah. But what I am saying is, we do, there are two different justice systems. Is their justice, yes, and it's just us. And I agree with you. We have to get to the point that we are regulating ourselves and so on and so forth. My only point of bringing that up is it is a black and white night and day type situation. And we need to make up our minds on how we will regulate it. It's never cool to drug a woman. Women, it ain't cool to drug men because that shit happens too. Yo. We just don't
shout
talk about it.
Sharper Tudo was a homeboy, the dude that got, that was with the one of the girls that got situation. He said nothing happened to him, though. He said he got drugged and passed out on the couch. Some man happened to him too, though. Look at Darren Sharper situation reading to it, though. Oh, it gets crazy. Shout out to Jeremy Stowe, exposed that to us all early in the game.
Right. But I just guess what my thing is, and I know not a lot of people like to speak on it. A lot of times when something is going to the left, everybody's going to go to the left. Someone's going to the right, same difference, mm-hmm. right? But my thing is with Bill Cosby, from how I understand it, you know, that, you know, you do have, the dude is a greaseball. And even before all of this stuff was coming out, I lost a lot of respect for Bill, unfortunately, when he, shit he was saying about black people. Now, I will say this. I don't disagree with everything he was saying. But I do think that him and a lot of people make this mistake of, we have conversations we need to have with ourselves.
Sales, yes.
In front of open company or mixed company. Mm-hmm. And to me, you're doing that to get the Toby head pack. You know what I'm saying? But it's just like, so I was cool on Bill. But it's just one of those things of like, I don't know. It's just something real murky about how that happened to Bill, as far as like, when is the cutoff of when people can say things happen? You know what I'm saying? And this is just me looking at fucked up things happen, but is it like murder? Because I heard murder, like if you murder, like a murder case or whatever, it's never, like that.
You can always prosecute a murder
case. Yeah. And it, I don't know, man. Like, I'm drinking this Glenlivet, and maybe I'm just getting emotional, but get I kind of just kind of have like an open, open-ended thought.
I know what you're saying, though, on that aspect.
But I agree with you. We got to make our mind up, like, and regulate our shit.
There was a lot of black women that were raped by Bill Cosby, too.
Yeah.
So,
and that's fucked up.
You know, like, we act like this was just a white woman thing.
Yeah.
Even if it was just a white woman thing, though, we still need to be morally correct.
Right.
If we gonna move forward as people, that we gotta be morally correct regardless of what they do. And my whole thing is, we want to oppress like they do. And a lot of motherfuckers just want to oppress like they do.
I do that on a deeper level.
They want the freedom to oppress like white people do.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter if it's right or wrong. I always say, it's saying like, they did that, why can't I do that?
This would be the most radical thing I say on y'all show. And trust me, you good. The thing is, even when, now things like, on a serious tip, with like, you know, just certain, I'll just say like, just activism, we'll just use that word. And I've been involved like since the 80s. And I've seen this fake woke movement that could definitely be something we talk about, you know what I'm saying, as far as the last decade and all of this other stuff.
That's got to die in this decade.
And here's my thing, to sum it all up, and where I am a person that I do, I'm a person, before I do my best, before I go on a deep end with what I think and how I feel, I just like to get all of the information and try to keep my emotions to the side. That's with Bill Cosby. That's with Robert Kelly. That's just with anybody. I know that's not popular to say, but it's a grown-up thing to say. But one thing I can say, when it comes to us, and I agree with you, Daryl, when people be like, fuck this system and blah, 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 I'm like, well, you do know, if you're saying fuck a system, the way that you've existed, your house, paying tax, you look, you can't be fuck the system and you pay your taxes and you looking for your tax return. You can't be fuck the system and you still want to exist how you exist. You know, the house, the this, that, and the dog that goes wolf wolf. So do you just want to exist in a pre-existing system and just kind of have the fire off your ass? Or are you really trying to do something else? And that's kind of it used to be one of my biggest arguments.
Mine is even more worse than that.
Yeah.
Mine is, we way more capitalistic than we are black.
Yeah, absolutely. I heard a brother say that we the new white people. And everybody got mad at him, but I understood why he said that.
Yeah.
The only reason why that can't stand up and it can't resonate fully is that a lot of the strength of what has been what we use to call white privilege, mm-hmm. is built on mass majority tactics, mm-hmm. and we still don't have that. You know what I'm saying? Because no. you saw that happen in the last presidential mm-hmm. election. Yeah. You know, you saw somebody not win the popular vote, but win the mass vote.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. That still is. You know what I mean? That still is the way things are. So we. It also, we're going to say things that we don't think are popular to say, is that I feel like black people can be racist. And then people say that black people can't be racist because we're not the majority. Mm-hmm. But if you prescribe to that, because at the basis, racism doesn't say that it has to be something that is based on there being, you have to be 10 of y'all, and if there's right. 9 of them, you're the majority.
It's right. based on power. It's based on power.
So can I jump in?
We can be a bigot, though. Black people can be
let me let me no, let me ahead. Let me bring that. Let me bring yeah, that full circle. Yeah. So the thing I'll say is that we are taking on a lot of the elements. I think that with success, and the way that we define success in some regards is the way that the other majority define that success to them as well. And that was, what do we do with it now?
Yeah.
You know, what do we do with how we have success that's different compared to them?
Right.
Because we still use it as privilege. We just use it as privilege within the culture.
Right.
And we use it against each other.
Yep.
Right.
When we can't, that's why we can't make the gains that some other minorities like the Jews and people like that have been able to make, because they said, no, we're going to, for the most part, we're going to try to do this together.
Yep.
And we'll distance ourselves and still stay within the system.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that when, you don't mind me, because I know you wanted to. Okay.
No, you can.
So to me, much love to the late, great Dr. Frances Cress Wilson, mm-hmm. and when she spoke on racism.
ISIS papers, if you might want to read the ISIS papers.
Yeah. When she spoke about racism, it was along the lines of racism being groupism. You know what I'm saying? And which is just pretty much, as a group, we do this, as a group, we do that. I think David Banner reiterated that as well. And so when you say, let me not get too radical on here, but I think when you say that black people can be racist, if it's in the form, if it's how I look at it, which is groupism, I would say that should we be prejudice and all of these things? No, but racism, practicing groupism, like you said,
mm-hmm.
sticking together instead of just using these ideas or this ideology of success and what we've been told success is, you know what right. I'm saying? And going against each other. No, we do need to practice groupism.
Yeah.
And with racism, how everybody explains it, a nigga could be racist. you know what I'm saying? That's the land of madness. Bing, you know, message. A black person being so-called prejudiced.
Time out. Glenn Levitt can make you a little bit more racist.
Right.
Irish Scotch whiskey.
And right, there you go.
You get racist.
So I just started feeling racist. You know, I don't like niggas. No, but.
Niggas?
Right. I damn forgot my point that I. Well, no, I was going to say that just a black man, black woman being racist, okay, or prejudice, which we really are saying, that's not going to strip away anybody's power. You know what I'm saying?
Right. All it's going to do is depower us.
People in power, and it's just like Daryl said, it's really a power game. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? So I agree with that.
So while we're talking about Cosby, I want to circle back around to a little bit of the turn of the decade here. Who took the biggest fall from 2010 to 2019?
Like Lewis.
Who entered?
Oh, over,
that was fast.
Over R. Kelly?
That was fast.
Well, R. Kelly was already on the
down. He already had sheets in the armor.
Down trajectory.
He was already in sheets and armor, though, for after the pissing tape.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that R. Kelly wasn't the same R. Kelly.
Yeah.
Even though he had like a one or two hits, it wasn't the same.
Yeah, he was wearing purple leather outfits and shit.
Yeah.
Wearing the mask and the interviews and all of that.
Yeah. It was only
called himself the Pied Piper.
You got to think Kanye started 2010... with fucking Dark Twisted Fantasy.
We were just
and
talking
now
about
he's fucking at a fucking choir thing that he fucking don't even know what the fuck.
No, let's just get this. Let me shorten where you were going to with this. He started off with making probably the most important album
yes.
of a decade in that regard. And now he is David Koresh.
That's 100. Okay.
He's about 6 months away from being David Koresh.
So, like, this is my whole thing with Sunday Service and the Sunday Service choir.
Shit.
I have a friend just as you all do that's in the choir. Yeah. So, like, the way the whole joint popped off, like, I feel like this is just me personally, like, out of nowhere, a few years back, Ye pops up with Trump. He's like, you know, trying to just basically pander his way in. Mm-hmm. And he was going through his debt situation at that time, too. He was like,
hey,
he was
broke.
He was nose deep in debt. And I think that, you know, this is my personal opinion because I wasn't there. I don't know the man. I do know him, but that's here nor there. But I don't speak to him. We not partners like that. He like just pandered his way in, and then all of a sudden he just came back and he was like, "Hey y'all, I'm saved now, and
come with me.
I'm gonna I'm gonna start this Sunday service thing, but I'm gonna use house music, and I'm gonna charge people to come to Sunday service and enjoy Sunday service with me.
And I got merch.
And I got merch. Right? Like, there's no difference between him and what's the old boy's name in Dallas? White boy Joel Osteen. Like, they're not doing anything. He performed at his church, but what I'm saying is, people, black people especially, we get so upset with one another. Like, well, these people, I would never go to a church and spend all my money and da 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 da. Like, churches are corporations. We're just gonna keep it 100.
Yeah,
that's what it is.
Have been
for years.
There's verse in books about the corporate church getting turned over, the stained glass renderings of the corporate church getting turned over. So wow.
Yes, sir.
Green leaf.
And I said that to say that, like we were talking, he went from pure artistry, you know, and we all know, like, you know, we can say that visibly after his mother passed, he went for a loop, you know, and that's only to be said. I personally have a theory that I think he blames himself for his mother's death.
Wow.
That could or could not be.
His own vanity.
Yeah.
Telling his mind, you could look better.
You could look better.
Get this plastic surgery and all that.
Yep. I think that he blames himself for that, and I think that he has internalized it, and I don't think he's found the right channels. All this is personal opinion again. I don't think he's found the right channels to really get that out. But I think that he's kind of figured out, well, you know what? Like, I remember having a conversation with Ye in 2004. Like, a real conversation. And I've told my lady this story numerous times. So I'm going to hit a couple of different points. Atlanta, Hot 107.9 birthday bash. I saw Ye. I had kicked it with him in St. Louis two times prior to that. And saw him at the birthday bash. Because, like, last time I saw him in St. Louis.
He was at the castle back then, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he was staying at the Chase. We went down to the Chase and had drinks with him and his people. So we're at Hot 107.9 birthday bash. He recognized us from, you know, the crib. He like, "Oh, y'all Midwest cats. I was John St. Louis." So we backstage. It's a fine little ATL shorty back there. Nice. Like, nice. Any of us would have went on in any given day. Like, right. Like, we don't keep 100. So, you know, everybody like, "Hey, yo, yeah, get on." And she at you. Like, she was at him. You know, this is white blazer, pink polo with pink the polo. Collar up. Yay, you know, the jeans with the Air Forces.
Bootcut.
And, bootcut jeans, bro. And, right. He looks and he says, "Yeah, man, I'm really not feeling us." So his partner was like, "What's up?" He's like, I'm not liking her toenail color, bruh. And everybody was kind of like, okay.
Right.
So I said that to say that in that same night, I had a conversation with him. And he told me, like, "Yo, I've just always wanted to be that guy." Mm-hmm. He was like, "You know, back when I was producing in my apartment in Chicago, like, I would get my producer checks," and he has an interview saying the same thing.
Right.
He's like, "I would get my producer checks and go straight on Mish Ave and buy up gear so that I could look like the dudes that was really getting it."
Right.
You know what I'm saying? He's like, he's all the money that Jay and Dame, and I was getting off my roof. He's like, I was spending it, like, right out. Right. He's like, "I could have did tons of other stuff, you know." He said, "But I always knew I was going to be that guy." He's like, "And if I wasn't going to be that guy, I was going to look like that guy."
Right.
So I said that to say, now he has this vision, and if I'm being real, I think he's shooting for Jay, and not at him, but just kind of trying to get to that level, because Jay's that guy.
Trying to do a different what route of it.
Yeah, like, how do I get there?
I want to do the Anakin Skywalker.
Yeah, like, how do I get there? Because, and this is me telling you, like, he told me, like, I want to be that guy. If we being real, amongst black men in pop culture, Jay is that guy.
Oh, he's it.
You know what I'm saying?
So, there's two types of cats you want to be.
But right? My thing is, like, so
hold up. I want to build on that. Jay has shaped, like, you see this whole decade, Jay is, like, shaped, like, all these cats that have come afterwards. Like, they're doing, there's like a new type of dude that's coming now. There's like a generational difference where they're not necessarily trying to be Jay, but they want to do the things that Jay has done, right, as far as like building up their business and things like that. Just like how all the young cats in the NBA want to be like LeBron. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But LeBron want to be like Jay. Like, Jay has been, like, the most influential African-American over the last 20 years for cats that aren't trying to be politicians.
I don't think there's no question.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, the thing I say is there's cats that want to be Jay, and then there's cats that want to be Obama. And I see a whole lot of aspiring politicians who want to be Obama, but they not going about doing it the way that he did it. Because that dude did a lot of hardcore boots to the earth work. And you see a lot of people setting themselves up not doing it that way. Now, that's been the biggest thing I've seen grow in the last decade.
So you're saying Jay and Obama are the biggest of 2010s?
Absolutely, but in two different lanes developed. Right, because of Obama existing, which was turning over, which had started at the beginning of the decade and carried into it, you've seen a whole genesis of different types of people develop because of that.
Yeah, I agree.
Where Jay was already doing it in 2000.
What about the hood guy? It's more like,
who's the most influential hood guy now? So for our generation,
Gucci Mane. Gucci Mane.
It ain't no question. Gucci Mane.
Here we go.
Omar off the Wire is an interesting person to bring up. He said, is it Omar off the Wire?
But Omar, that series ended in 2009. Though.
But I'm saying, though, the legacy continues. Right. You know what I'm saying? It was many a year where Jay didn't drop an album this past decade, but his influence didn't go nowhere.
Okay. Right. Yeah.
It's been a lot more. All right, how do I do this? There's been a lot more sensitive thugs this decade than any decade before.
Definitely been
before.
A lot more sensitive.
A lot of sensitive
thugs. That's been the biggest growth.
I think Omar was no sensitive thug. So we used the word
it was
Omar.
Gay and it was a thug.
But that's what I'm. Okay, so you just did what I was trying not to do. But go here for it though. There's been a lot more.
I'm saying he wasn't sensitive.
Sexuality has a lot less to do now with somebody's really about that life than ever before.
100%. I have a curveball theory though. So earlier it was a term. What was it? The Negro Sonic Diaspora.
We're getting to it. All right.
I totally forgot what that meant. But the hood diaspora, think about it. I think that may be what created sensitive thugs. See, if you would not see my brother, if you were not in the mecca of thuggery, let's say you move from like, you know.
So you're trying to say the thug hood?
I'm saying like if you are a thug. You know, in thug land, and I'm pretty sure, like, let's use St. Louis, for example.
Like Negro Town.
Like Negro Town. And you move out, you know, your family, you know, moving on up, and you go out to Clayton or somewhere, or Ladue or whatever.
There's still a thug element, but eventually. No, we got to stop that. There's a lot of stops before your family going to go from.
You don't know that, though. You don't know that. Hey, that dope. Hey, I'm just saying, I'm not, you know.
It's hard to just go straight to Clayton.
My comment is very lubricated, so there's no dry snitching here, but you never know where illegal funds can take you.
But there's still a lot of off ramps, though, because there's a lot of old money over there, and they're going to definitely be like, what do we know you from? What's going on?
Hey, we just used the whole. I was a janitor for 20 years at Walmart. I just saved my money.
I'm glad y'all said I'm about to make some reservations for restaurant week in Clayton because I'm certainly at that stop in this week. So thank you for bringing
that. What's the date?
It's January 13th through the 19th. Okay. So getting that
y'all in Clayton. But no, I'm just saying, like, you could just go somewhere and then you just become more open to other things in life. You want to hold on to your thugness, but you may like cucumber water. That will make you a little sensitive.
I think the sensitivity has been welcomed more in the second half of the decade.
Oh, 100%. Drake is the one.
You can't put that on Omar.
You put that on Drake.
No, I said Drake's aspirations of a hood would be Omar.
Omar was like, yo, that dude respected, but he gay. It's all good.
Yeah. I wasn't even looking at the gay element, though. So I was just looking at the hood shit.
Omar forced you to be like, hey, I got to respect him, even if he is. Yeah. That was... Man, you talk about things that grew in the last decade. Was that image of homosexuality being something you can just put on TV and it's not like, oh my God, what happened?
I still
think they try to force it into places it doesn't have to be in some things now. Right. Like, I was at Star Wars and they had a cutscene of two chicks kissing. And I was like, I mean, I feel like y'all threw that in there kind of egregiously.
Let me ask, what's the Balenciaga? What's the name of the fly shit? I don't know how to even pronounce it.
Balenciaga. Yeah. Balenciaga.
So my man's out there got the Ciaga jumpsuit with the makeup bag with the Glock in it. Like, that's your typical thug. And his cross chest, too.
Yeah, that's
2019.
You get your Glock right here.
Right.
Yeah, that's real. That's real.
Oh shit!
That's real.
So hold on. Is that legal to do that?
Yeah, in Missouri.
No, I'm saying, is it legal to make a area for you to pull out your gun from?
Yeah,
Maybelline Mac.
Absolutely.
I mean, dude, I saw a dude on David Banner's podcast that had the bulletproof vests.
Those are like, so those are more fashionable now. It's not really like a real vest. It's a fashion piece now. It's not like, cat get hit, he's going down.
I would say they claim that it's.
They actually have more Fashion Nova now, so.
I would say that these guys claim that it's.
Real.
Real.
And they could be. They could be. They could not be. I mean.
I just don't want to buy no fat. If I'm going to get a bulletproof vest, I'm not going to get it from Fashion Place. I want to get it from.
Well, actually, it's illegal to own a bulletproof vest, so.
From is this illegal?
Yeah.
You can't do that unless you.
Average civilian. Like, a civilian can't own a bulletproof vest.
Unless, that's like, right underneath that same category, silencers and stuff like that. Yeah. You can't.
So, hold on. So, if I walk out with a bulletproof vest, in general, I'm going to get locked up, potentially.
Yeah. I mean, like, there's certain stipulations. I don't know them, but you need, like, special licensing and stuff. Like, it's federal. Like, you have to have, like you said, silencers and all that. Like, you have to have special licensing and stuff for that. So, I would imagine, like, if you're a celebrity, you have, like, a security team, stuff like that. You know what I'm saying?
What if I'm just a regular dude that work at UPS?
No, sir. You'll get locked up.
Even though if you're a dude at UPS, you might could fuck around and
need one.
You need one.
Hey, that's one thing I'm going to tell you that's mad different now than it was any other. Like, these last two Christmases, the cats have been dropping off shit at my house. Like, I'm like, what the fuck is this walking up on the crib? And he's like, oh, I got your Amazon package. I'm like, yo, they need to all be in the Amazon car. They all need to be in there so I know
so they just are. Showing up.
It be cats be pulling up in cars, horses.
Trucks. Yeah, real talk. Like,
you know, shout out to Adrian, my MVP,
Your MVP.
He's my MVP now. He wants to change the MVP.
No, he's a superstar.
No, he asked me to change
the MVP. I don't care what he asked. This is the life he chose for himself. He don't get to. Let me make sure. Y'all aware of our theory of what a.
The ranking of a crew.
Of what a crew is comprised of.
I'm not. I would love to hear.
Every crew has this. All right. So let's take
let's do it for the zoo for the new listeners.
Let's
get in the new year. Let's do it. All
right. So make sure I don't miss any of the trees because I was so proud the other day. My lady used this in talking about her crew. Like used
We've never done the women crew thing though.
It's happening soon this year. Like she
the
used
crew
it.
Thing is way more simpler though. But way more complex.
But we can't go down.
Yeah, we're no.
So every crew has people that are assigned to specific roles, whether it's known or whether it's not. So our theory on this is that each one of these roles, you can look back at your crew at some point in your life and that they're going to be, you can figure out who goes into it.
Right.
So it starts with a superstar. Now, a superstar is the guy that people will look at from the outside and look in and be like, oh, man, that's the man right there.
Right.
And like that's who people look at in the crew and be like, all right, that's the centerpiece of that crew.
Mm-hmm.
That may or may not be true within that crew. But either way,
but the people think that.
So share the elements of the superstar.
The next step is the negotiator.
No. Share the elements of the superstar. I'm gonna introduce.
The superstar is basically the he's out there. And he's the one like every girl likes him. Like he's dope. He's the one that brings everybody into the crew. But he probably don't even like all the girls in general because he's a superstar. And he feels like he's above all of them.
Word.
He feels like he's above all of them. Like you know, I ain't worried about it. For real, honestly, you know what? I don't even like her for real, though. Gee, I ain't gonna.
You can have her if you want to. That type of cat. So then after that is the utility man.
Mm.
Now the utility man can do literally anything that's called upon for the crew to get through. So at some point in the night, you might need somebody who needs to negotiate at the door. There is a person that does that specifically. We'll touch on that next. But this person can literally step up. If the superstar is not around, he can most likely be a superstar as well.
Okay. But also, he has to fill in for the superstar, fill in some of the whole superstar is blind at.
Yes.
His blind spots.
Yes.
Nice.
Like,
nice.
His blind spots are like, you know what? I ain't know about that, though. And you're like, you know
so
what?
So is he kind of like the cleanup man?
That's a good way to look at it. Okay. You remember when Kyrie hit that shot in the against the Warriors to actually win the series when they beat the Warriors?
Uh-huh.
He was being the utility man because LeBron was a superstar. He stepped up in that moment and was that guy.
Gotcha.
You know, so after that is the negotiator. Now, the negotiator is the smooth talker. He's the one that can get, walks up to the door, make sure everything's
good. He's the one
who's
like, yo, he going to go up there and he going to get us in there.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
He got the crew. Or he going to be like, he the one that's just going to. Whatever talking needs to be done,
right?
He's like the one that's gonna do it.
When your guy crew rolls up on a lady crew and it's like, hey ladies, what's going on tonight? How y'all doing? You know, that dude,
he's the one
that
introducing himself.
Yeah.
Mm.
Now that the utility man can do that, but he's not as efficient as a negotiator.
Yeah.
I mean, as a negotiator, or he's not as out there as a superstar, but he'll do it if he got to.
Like, he's a jack of all trades, but a specialist in none. No, that's right. A utility man. And then after that, you have your henchman.
The henchman.
Who is, you know.
He jumps on the bomb.
Yes. So that is.
That's what me and Daryl used to say for years, man. Gotta jump on the bomb.
And at times, he might throw the bomb, too. You know what I'm saying? He's the one where you gotta be like, yo, make sure he don't drink too much before we go out. Because you know how he gonna get. Like, that's the one.
So let me ask Daryl this. He's the one who can point you in the direction of the back streets. How we used to talk about the back streets.
But he's also a savage.
Okay.
He's the savage. He's the one's like. No, I'll take that too.
Y'all know. I got it. She smells like oatmeal cookies. I'm fucking.
No, it's cool.
That's all
me. Don't even worry about that. I got that.
I'll give you a scenario of where I was way back in the day, 15 years ago. Now I've been like, I don't know, man. We got a nice situation here, but we don't know exactly how we're going to work this out. Okay. I know what we need to call. Yeah. And he came on through and was like, with it. Don't matter. Yeah. Yeah. That's
all. We good. Hey, there is a guy like that in every crew, bro.
He just going to come through. And he going to entertain and hang out. They're going to be like, oh, man, he's so cool. And he going to take the lead. Like, oh, I'll take who is the lowest barrel. I'll take the lowest one.
So this is real interesting because I think in my life, especially at the height of my nightlife days as a promoter, event coordinator, host, hyper-manish. Mm-hmm. I've probably been all of those in one night.
You're a utility man.
Yeah. But then it's just kind of like time plays a key, too. Because
utility man's got to be a savage, too, though.
Like, yeah. I mean, I ran with a crew of savages, and that got us.
At the peak of my career as being a Scottie Pippen.
Yeah. That's solid.
I did.
I looked at myself as more of a Jason Kidd type.
So.
I'm Sean Kemp. Sean Kemp.
Oh, no, that means you're a savage.
Yes, that means you're a savage.
You're a savage.
I would say
you already thought.
Hold on, there's three.
Brandon Williams.
There's three more in the crew. Okay.
There's one more people. So there's also the wheel man. Now the wheel man's gonna be the one that's gonna be able to get you out of any situation, but he also gonna know where it's at. He'll know where to be. Hey, we need to be here tonight. We need to be where that's where it's at. But yo, like, oh shit, hey, we need to get going. Or hey, your girl just walked in. Oh, all right, you know what I'm saying? Like your guy that can do those things for you. Yeah. We also have the happy to be there guy. So this is a guy that's not quite in the crew, but he'd be popping in, and you know he would be always down to be in it. But he happy to be there.
But you gotta watch him though.
But what he gonna do?
He actually converted himself into a henchman though. It's like the mafia. He's like the dude that'll put in work though to become a full member.
I feel you. But the happy to be there guy could be plotting on a superstar spot.
The
happy to be here guy more often than not has gotten around the crew because he knows the superstar. Right. The superstar's not thinking about crew dynamics.
What I'm saying.
He's not thinking about the crew.
How loyal will the happy to be there? I'm telling you, like, it's people. The happy to be there guy is kind of to me like the nut rider.
He's a friend of all.
No, look at it.
But you never really know his agenda.
I've seen a lot of happy beaters convert themselves into being other different positions than what within a
happy to be there.
Staying loyal to the crew that they're kind of in.
Sometimes the happy to be there is also a little brother too.
You're basically nurturing him into being. Something else. You help burden to some other thing.
Like when Frank Pantangeli came to Michael Corleone and said, "Why can't I kill the Rizzuto brothers?" And he said, "Because your family is still Corleone."
He said,
"You told us that when you made the move west, that you would let me break off and form my own family." He was happy to be there. And then when you grow that person up and get them where it is, they can break off and maybe form their own family. And if not, what they'll do is they'll buy a lot of drinks for the women at least, so nobody else has to do that.
So I'm glad you brought the chaplain. The last one is the chaplain. Okay.
He's the moral compass of the group.
Yes, the chaplain.
He's one like, man, we can't be fucking all these women, no, man. Y'all acting up. Y'all doing wrong.
Right.
Y'all, like, why are we doing
why this? He getting double head? You know, he just bust quick and came in.
No, it's not a hating thing. He's literally like a moral compass. Like, yo, oh, all right, I know we're doing what we're doing. He may be in the street store at that point, but he's like, you out of bounds what you're doing.
I feel you. I feel everybody's position in that except the happy to be there guy.
You know he exists, though.
Yeah, he does exist, but he's shifty, I'm telling you.
No, it's very hard to be with him. Yeah, no, no. That's a very tripping situation.
Like, look at, okay, dude. Like, you can't, we're not going to say the real name.
He could also be Donnie Brasco.
I would say, oh my God, you know, Eddie Haskell would have been a happy to be there guy. And you've seen his track record. He's a happy be there guy. Huh?
He's a happy be there guy that became, he's fucking like, he's like a John Gotti. If anybody knows the history of John Gotti, he's a dude that was he was a fucking henchman, happy be there dude. He built himself up. He just stayed around, being there. He ended up being a driver, ended up doing all stuff. Then he killed Casemiro.
But if you're the superstar or even the utility guy, man, you better keep your back against the wall around Eddie Haskell.
Yeah,
because you could catch a bullet out of somewhere.
Yeah. Oh, Eddie Haskell.
And he's going to get with the moral guy, and they're going to have a conversation.
Yes. Never trust Eddie Haskell in my life. I won't trust him right now at a traffic light. If he drive before me. Oh, I'm gonna stay and wait.
You just gotta.
So it's important. It's important.
That shit's dope, though. I like that.
It's important. I always encourage everybody to go back and figure out, you know, your crew and know where your crew is at. Because I definitely have mine worked out.
There's interchangeable things. You may be a different position in different crews.
Yes, absolutely.
I've been a lonesman with my crew.
I've been the happy to be that guy with the crew. Yeah. So here's an example of when I was the happy to be that guy and I ascended.
Trying to get made.
Very apt way to describe that. I was trying to get online. I had to be a happy to be there guy to get down. But then I got in, and now I have my own family.
But you are a loyal. It's about character. Okay, maybe I'm looking into it too deep. But you remember like a when loyal we was in
Chicago?
Guy.
We was in Chicago about 12 years ago, and we was kicking it.
Yeah.
I was the happy to be there guy with Jeff and Kobe and them because them was my OGs.
But okay, I got you. But here's the thing. And shout out to Jeff and Kobe and the homies. Here's the thing: how you carried yourself. If you was a happy to be there guy, the way you carried yourself, you was to me. I was like, man, this dude is already a boss or a boss in the making.
Well, people of my own age, yes.
Yeah,
but I had to learn up.
Yeah. Oh, you're learning up. But I'm learning saying sometimes I agree with the basic definition of the happy to be there guy. I've just seen happy to be there guys turn into the assassins.
Yeah. Oh, and I agree with that. Yeah. It's a sketchy.
The story of Haskell. Yeah. Like there.
Yo, it's a sketchy borderline position to be in.
Yeah.
It is absolutely that. So yeah, absolutely.
And usually, just real quick, if you're the happy to be there guy, you could also fuck around and get like depending on what crew you around, they might have you do some serious shit.
Yeah.
No,
so you gotta prove yourself. So that's what you said about somebody becoming a henchman and becoming the main man. So forth.
He's becoming the main man because you've already
done it. Daryl had one of the best henchmen in St. Louis, without a doubt. He still is a henchman to this day.
I know this henchman.
Yeah. Oh, we can. He's fine.
He's a great henchman.
He's one of the greatest henchmen.
Because you got a thorough crew.
I could fly him out to be a henchman for me. Don't be like, yo, I need you just handle that.
Not little bro, is it?
No, not my
little
brother.
Yeah, that's my boy.
That's my guy, man. Roy's
boy. No, Roy's not a henchman. Now you stop it. You know he's a negotiator.
Yeah, Roy's a great negotiator.
Roy, that's my guy. I've seen him move up in the ranks.
Real man.
He's a negotiator. No, he's a negotiator by far.
I got to give Roy a negotiator.
Yo, he will talk everything through.
Yeah.
Your henchman. Now, let's get into this. Some of the most important spots, because I'm going to pivot this into talking about the girl crew right after we get done with this, too. Yeah, I see. Yeah, I did that.
The girl crew is way more.
Hold on. Before you do it, because you're about to get real passionate, and you're going to get really passionate about this, too. Uh-oh. But when it comes down to your crew, man, if you got a great henchman, man, you really can get away. In some cities, you need for some roles to be better than others. And you need a good henchman in a city like St. Louis.
Yeah.
You got to have a good one. Because he can't be just the fly off the handle because he's going to get shot. Yeah. But you got to have somebody who's going to really be about handling.
Because the henchman also will fight for you, though, too.
Absolutely.
He's also muscle.
Yeah, you need thinking people around you at all times, regardless of who they are.
But
because your henchman also sometimes can still, he might not be the biggest cat, but he might be that cat that'll pick up a bottle and be like, you know, fuck this. I'm tired of this.
Right.
Bow. And then you're just like, oh, shit. Now we got to go.
Right.
Now it's on, yeah.
I was that type of henchman in my peak OC days.
So you moved up through the ranks, though. Like
I've done everything you could possibly do. I don't really like superstar. I've
done everything.
I'm not too good at superstar.
No, I got to give you superstar utility guy, man.
Utility guy is my natural position.
Now I've seen you dip into the henchman and you were dealing with a henchman, and I'm glad the two henchmen recognized from.
And you know what the funny thing about that whole encounter was is that that was a clear henchman,
yeah.
But I'm a covert one, yeah. Where it's like you would look at, once again, light-skinned dude, see, white shirt. Fuck this guy. I'm going to say
what I'm going to that's my guy from years and years, and I knew he was a henchman. But I looked at you as a superstar, but I always saw the henchman trait because I pay attention to how people speak. I don't go off of what I see.
Yeah.
I look at your character. I'm like, oh, yeah, Matt a cut ass. Let me jump off the stage and get in the middle of that. You know what I'm saying?
Well, it was good because, I mean, Focus was there. You know, had family. We both had family. And my real family and his extended family, you know, it works out. But that's St. Louis, though.
Yeah.
That's St. Louis. And most cities, when you have that crossover, when you got two crews, but you got to make sure that a crew, you don't put somebody in the middle of two of their crews.
Yeah. But the thing is, though, when you travel, your position may change.
Absolutely.
That's true.
Absolutely.
I could say in this situation that we're speaking about, though, it's kind of like, it was really dope because I would say I was like the Michael, I told you Michael Jackson off of beat it. Come on, man, we can't be doing this. And it is just like two henchmen recognize, hey, this is mutual family.
You're the utility guy on your crew, you know that, right?
Yeah, I would say I've been.
No, you're the utility
guy. I would say I've been superstar utility.
No, but no, though.
The henchman when I was coming up.
I would
up.
Say that you are elite utility guy in the history of St.
Yes.
Louis.
No,
oh, actually, my
no,
God.
No. Actually, you know what? Real talk, we may need to get you a plaque, though.
Elite.
You are the elite of utility.
When I had a curl bob, I would say I was like a superstar.
Not the
but
curl
it wasn't,
bob.
He didn't feel comfortable.
No. Actually, you are the godfather of utility.
Oh my God, you gotta explain this shit.
Man. I might start calling you Vito.
Yeah, that's what
I'm saying. Oh man.
Look. No. We call him Tom Hagen, conciliary.
No, Tom Hagen is a negotiator.
Since he underboss.
Okay, you gotta kick this. Cause we all have everybody sitting at this table for the people listening. We have a deep, deep history in St. Louis from everything is just being friends to like nightlife events to other things that will never be discussed on air. Truly you all missed the greatest conversations before we hit record.
Yeah.
This is kinda like PG-13, but anyway.
AI's a superstar though.
I would give AI superstar.
It depends on the crew.
I would give AI superstar.
Nah, Doug, you actually are literally responsible for everybody's good times.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's what I would give.
There's been plenty of times where I was going to rap with AI at some given club or something. I have to just do the long distance dap because there's too many people.
But I see that.
By definition, I see what you're saying.
No. But you train me. You kind of give me like a little Jedi
nothing
training.
But positive things. Go ahead.
A little Jedi training, though.
Yeah.
And everything, though, about certain things. You gave me my Jedi name. Swiss Backstreets.
Clem gave you that.
No, it was y'all together. Y'all were together.
Now, I would say Clem is the ultimate utility guy.
Oh, no. Clem is a superstar.
I would give Clem superstar. In our crew, when we all ran together, I would say him and I, depending on the city and the situation, could switch out.
Right, but
I would give you
overall,
superstar.
But in general,
I would give you superstar. But now that we've broken down the,
no, I see why Daryl.
Yeah,
because I definitely would give you a superstar. I would give you superstar.
I'm never gonna want to be in front of nobody.
No, we gotta give you superstar.
I never
with drunken powers.
No. Daryl, Adrian always is.
He was a silent assassin, bro.
Adrian always.
Daryl is a silent assassin.
Adrian's always a front. If anybody's gonna step a super, like, be
your
boy. Yeah, Roy would have stepped up.
They love their curly head.
Y'all kind of like the 96 Bulls.
I never
wanted
to be a front.
Anybody who could kind of
step up. I never wanted to be a front.
But your personality. That's what I'm saying. Sometimes.
But I never
wanted
to be a front.
So, like, look, when I do parties, I would say the ultimate utility because at some point I have to be a superstar.
Yeah,
then
I
have to go into, like, negotiation.
No, but I would be a superstar and to get my superstar up. To make yourself like, I need to be back being a superstar. Because he being a superstar, I need to get back in my spot.
This is great, by the way.
This is awesome. I hope the people will enjoy this, man.
No. So
and you, I guess we got another one. 20 minutes before we wrap it up.
So sometimes, as a utility man, you know, your superstar be like, oh, shit, he in a superstar spot. I need to get, you know what? I'm back to superstar. Let's go.
So here's I'll give you
an example. Because he does not want to be a superstar.
My crew is the crew that I would refer to, this is a multi-city crew. So dude that would be the superstar in my crew, I had to like get him in the club before. So like I had to be the utility man and the slide. I would get in my ID.
Slide back.
Yeah. The same dude that just got into the club back to back.
Okay.
Like, that's utility, man. I don't want to score 30 a night. That ain't really me. I don't want to shoot that much. But I do want to get a couple rebounds. I want to get some steals. I want to get some assists. You know what I'm saying? But I want to definitely get the. I want to get my shots up.
Like
that. So I'm gonna get my game up.
So if we're looking at it at a club scene, the superstar is just the one who's keeping everything moving. He's the look.
He's the one that keeps everything moving.
But the utility man is the one who like really just got everything. I think everybody at this table is a utility man and possibly a utility woman.
We're gonna talk about that.
But I look, really I think all of us can shift into superstar mode.
Yeah, that's the
definition of utility. So the superstar can actually panic given certain situations.
The superstar can't do anything else.
No, okay. He has no other position he can play.
There's nothing.
I would say me and Clem was two supreme utilities, but I see why you say Clem would be the superstar.
Yeah,
like we all ran together. Clem truly was. It still is, in my opinion, the guy, the life.
The superstar might be wrong.
But the superstar cannot do negotiator. He can't do utility. He can't do henchman. He can't do wheel man. He can't be the
I think that's what made me and him a crazy duo, because we both could switch at any given time.
Well, that's a two-man crew. That's a different thing, though.
You're talking about a two-man crew.
A two-man crew.
We're not. We have to come back to this.
Like on The Mandalorian, they say, y'all are now, y'all a clan of two.
Yeah. Or what was the big bank robbery? In LA, where it was just two dudes with the Kevlar on their ears walking through shooting everybody. It was just them two.
Oh, shit, that sounds like Heat.
Right.
It was close to Heat, though.
What was it based on?
It was them two white dudes that was military dudes.
Yeah.
They had the Kevlar on with the full everything.
They went out like G's, bro.
Like 21
they both got killed, though. Yeah. It was like
in the middle of the street, just so let's
use
banging
this,
out.
Let's use this in a, I'm going to use a movie scenario here for this. Okay. So, like, Iron Man was a superstar in his crew.
Of the Avengers.
He was absolutely a superstar. He didn't even have the ability to do it.
Right.
The utility man was absolutely Captain
America.
Like, not even close.
I can see that.
Your henchman, very clearly, it was the Hulk.
Yeah.
Happy to be here was kind of Hawkeye, because it's like, what you going to do when you run out of arrows?
Hawkeye slash N-Man. Well, maybe he's more talking about
the OG Avengers, though. I'm talking about the...
So this is before Black Panther and them showed up to hang out.
Yeah.
So and Thor is the negotiator?
I thought Thor would be like a henchman. No, Thor's actually got real responsibilities. He's just not great at balancing them. Okay. I would say he's absolutely the negotiator.
The negotiator, not a henchman.
He just... No, the Hulk has to be the henchman.
Just straight, ready to go.
That is the mold for a henchman, is the Hulk.
Hulk is the setup for it.
And then you had your, which one did I just miss? Your negotiator. No, your negotiator. Your negotiator might have been Black Widow. Because she was going to talk your way into anything.
Like, so what was Vision?
Vision was in the second movie. I got to account for a lot more with him.
Oh, okay.
He's happy to be here because he was like the
spawn. He's definitely happy to be here.
So that's kind of how I look at it. Thor was the negotiator. He might be the wheel man. Yes.
The wheel man.
Absolutely, Thor is the wheel man. Because he's going to get out. Like, when he showed up in Wakanda. Yeah. All right, we getting the fuck out of here.
Right. Let's go.
Yeah. They shooting. We leaving right now. That's a dope wheel man.
That's real.
So now we'll pivot to girl crew.
Okay. Can I ask a quick question before you go to the girl crew?
Sure.
Between the superstar and the utility man. So it's a safe assumption that the superstar has a great respect for the utility.
Oh, best friend.
Because this is he. Because to me, friends. It sounds like the utility man is actually the nucleus.
Yes,
of course.
Okay, so he has to.
Because you can go out.
Actually, the negotiator and the superstar probably have the most beef.
Well, that's where I was going with it.
They had the most.
That's where I was going because the most, actually,
the negotiator thinks he really wants to be the superstar.
He wants to form his own family.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, that just made a whole lot of sense.
The negotiator, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's real.
Because he gets damn near 70% of the perks of the superstar.
That's true.
But he ain't the superstar.
That's real.
He's taxing the deals that he's setting up in order for the superstar to shine and the utility man to work.
Yep. The utility man keeps the negotiator and actually the superstar from not riding on each other.
That's
but usually what happens though is that the negotiator and the utility man have like a undercurrent that like keeps them together. Like they cousins.
Yeah.
Or like they
Which is crazy.
Or like they Which like they line brothers or something like that. Where it's like this is somebody you gonna fight with.
Yeah.
But y'all not really gonna ever fall out.
Yeah.
Right.
That type of thing. So
that makes sense.
Damn, this like is some dope. Y'all gotta go.
Yeah, no.
So we moving on to the ladies.
I mean, look,
we're gonna propose some things because this is gonna be a larger show that has to happen down the road eventually, where this position gets defended because most of the time this causes some static when this gets brought up.
Okay. So, you want to? Can we pull in? Pull in,
yeah, absolutely. Tap sure. In? We can. You can absolutely give. So for all the listeners that are here, we also have a live studio audience today that's going to join the show. Like when Oprah used to take that microphone up into the stage. Like, what's your name? Where are you from? Why don't you, you know, tell us, you know, what's your question for the crew? So here's our thing. Here's the first thing I'm going to say about this is that with a lady crew, number one, the numbers are never as big as the guy crew, ever. It's always a smaller group of people, and that shit can get shook up at a moment's notice.
Real.
It can break off into being three different families in one night before it comes back to
whether they know it or not.
And based off of what women say, a lot of women, just real quick, because I know, Matt is getting ready to lace this shit. This shit is dope. I do want to say this, though. Having an older sister, growing up in a house of women, knowing women, I like women. I'm a lesbian myself, in case you didn't know. Mm-hmm. A lot of women, a lot of women, I hear, don't really fuck with other women.
Which really causes a huge complication in an all-female crew, right?
Man, you gotta kick this shit.
So think about, like, when
Bobby I'm just gonna Brown, hand you the mic, so here, so you can
think
have
about when Bobby Brown went on stage singing Mr. Telephone Man in the New Edition movie.
Right.
And you just like, hold on, he's going off the rails now. This isn't the script. Or when Bobby stayed on stage and Belle Biv DeVoe is like, hey, it's our turn. We gotta go out here and get our time.
Right.
That is what it looks like to me from the outside looking in, and sometimes being on the inside looking in,
right,
of a female crew, where it's, hey, they good, but the superstar role in the female crew is unlike anything in the male crew, because that female superstar really fucking feels like it. Yeah. Like, it's like playing with Carmelo Anthony.
Tracy Ross.
Like, this is my crew and the rest of y'all are here with me.
Right.
That type of thing. Like like the Temptations movie. It's more like,
you talking about
ain't nobody coming to see you, Otis.
Otis?
Exactly. That's what so there's not as many roles, first of all.
Right.
But female crews do also run a hell of a pick and roll too, because they have to feed off of each other.
And they have a smaller amount of people.
Yes.
And they also have to protect each other too. There's a whole nother dynamic in female crews where they have to be like, hey, we are leaving. A dude crew will break. Hey, I'm gonna holler at you later on. You have a good night. My superstar left one time with my keys, wallet. No, he's like,
superstar will leave you. Out of there.
I didn't get my keys to my house back for like 24 hours. Like, hey man, where you at? You got my cell phone and my keys. Like, that ain't happening in a girl crew,
right,
unless they get into a fight and fall out midnight. That's the difference as I see it. Now, you can correct me. You can correct me where I'm going wrong.
Introduce yourself. Do you have a handle you want to go by? Or you?
No, I don't. No. I don't have a handle. My name's Maria from Chicago.
Hi, Maria.
Shot Town. Oh, we were just talking about Shot Town.
Mm-hmm. What part of Chicago are you from?
Hyde Park.
Oh, shit. Okay. I'm from the South Shore.
Oh, okay.
How do you feel about Mr. Trubisky remaining in the Bears?
Okay. That's real depressing, though. Okay. For general for us,
there's a lot of people from Chicago that are really sad right now. Yeah. But please continue.
I think girl crews are a little different. Well, you already said that, but I think that there's a lot, to your point earlier, girl crews are super complex, and that's because what you find in girl crews is that a lot of the way you were raised comes out and how women interact with each other. So something that you said, a lot of women who don't fuck with other women, I think my personal opinion about that, and this might stir some people up, I think a lot of those women have some serious issues.
I don't have a whole bunch of girls,
like any woman that you cannot get along with their own kind, there's something wrong with that person. You know what I mean?
My sister crazy.
Shout out to me. So I think that a confident woman will be able to be friends with other women and be around other women and lift those women up. So
touche.
Yeah. So, and then the superstar comment, that's, I don't have to think on that one a little bit. That's interesting. But you're right, we would not leave without everybody. Mm-hmm. So
it could be argued that the most complex move that has to be played in a young man's life is how to pull one part of a crew away.
Bruh. Oh my God.
That's why Backstreets, boy.
When people say the things, what are you proud of?
What
are you proud of?
Yo, hold up. You can't even. I'm sorry. I'll give you the mic back real quick. So breaking down the crew, because we got to come back to you. You can't even be in a crew. If you can, and this is not to objectify women or anything, but we talking about the game, 10 toes down. If you were not a man who has the ability, no matter what you are in that crew, even the happy-go-lucky, you cannot be around us if you do not possess the ability to be able to extract a woman from her clique, pull her to the side, and just have a conversation for whatever it is you're trying to do. There are qualifications to be in these crews. That's all I want to say.
Here you go. And here's what I'm going to say, too, is that now that's the sign of an elite, elite-level negotiator who can pull a crew apart so that you can make way for that superstar to get in. Now let's talk about, let's design a couple plays here.
Oh, shit,
so,
you're making me think of a story,
so,
too.
So, when you have an elite negotiator, he can come in right away and start to maneuver that situation. He's going to set the pick.
He might even take the L on somebody.
You don't have to take the L if you got the whole crew together, because your henchman will take the L.
Well, I got a curveball, and this goes back to, he should start laughing. So there was a time, and sometimes, especially in St. Louis, crews cross paths, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Everything is fair in the city. And so there's a time that, okay, let's say, even though I think Gerald is a superstar, let's say top utility man. So there are times where there's been a meeting of the utilities, the utility men. And with that has to come a great form of confidence. It has to come a great form of understanding and recognize that, you know, I don't know how to say it without indicting anybody. Sometimes it's like, hey.
It's indicted.
Hey, I got this NBA Jams game. Mm-hmm. Yo, what's the serial code on that? Why would you ask me that? Yo, what's the serial code? Yo, that was the same NBA Jams joint I had. Mm. Now, are you a person to be like, man, you played this motherfucking game before me? Or are you going to be like, yo, did you leave some of them codes in there?
That's real.
Oh, you can
shout out NBA Jam.
So that's what I'm saying. But we got to get back to the sister in the...
Yeah, but that's one that's going to be... That's a hard one, man.
This shit is hype. Interested in what y'all finna say about the women crews.
Yeah. Well,
so you got the names?
Well, hold on. It's really interesting that you guys are talking about tearing the crew apart in the club.
Not tearing it apart. It's a merger.
Extracting.
Yes.
It's a dance. It's a dance. Because they're y'all doing what y'all want. We're doing what we want. And it's a constant.
And we're both there for different things in the same
atmosphere. So you go to extract a woman from her group.
Here's the thing.
Every crew has a different.
Grabs the Glenn lever.
Generally, if a man goes,
right, yeah.
If a woman is with her friends, like say there's like three of us.
Yes, ma'am.
And
that's always a good. That's the trio is always a good situation.
That is the most preliminary.
That's the highest level of a woman crew.
Touche.
The most that a female crew can exist long term is a crew of three.
Yeah.
If you get when it gets over seven, three, though, that's when it problems. Gets real.
That's why girlfriends didn't go as many seasons as it could.
Exactly.
That's four of them.
And they went out of three.
Mm. But, so, if there's a group of three of us, we would generally look down on a dude if he bought one of us drinks and not all three of us.
There you go.
See, this is where the bullshit would come in.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's the play that I was running
there. I already know a play to do.
Yeah, my negotiation.
You're like, hey, you know what? We just come to see how y'all was doing. Hey, what's your name? Oh, you blah blah blah. So basically, you got to come over and fill out their negotiator though, because you got to neutralize their negotiator.
You have to neutralize the
negotiator. Get your way. You have to neutralize.
Rule number one: never directly engage the female superstar.
No, never. You cannot do it.
Make her feel like you're not even as paying attention.
Because that's how you put a tank in the armor. That's how you do it.
Only way the superstar has to approach you as a man for you to be able to get the superstar.
Mm-hmm. And you also have to be able to say, yes, exactly.
He's kind of cool. And she's got to be like, hey, what's going on? Boom. Then you can slide in there.
But see, also, I would send a henchman at her just to shake things up.
Ooh, be careful.
I feel you. Oh, it's risky.
That's zero dark thirty shit.
It is a zero dark 30, but then that's if you're a negotiator and utility men are of elite status, and you shake it up with the henchman. So he's already swung and missed, and he doesn't give a fuck. Just give him some Glenn well, Levitt. Yeah, he'll be okay.
But that's fine. But no, giving
that nigga some right, but see, the thing is, just move in. Like,
the thing is, the utility man or the negotiator come in. They pull everybody's presence down. They start getting everybody laughing.
Yes,
and bring everybody.
Because your henchman played the part, though. He was supposed to be the.
But the henchman is the henchman actually comes in and gets the little fourth girl. That they brought.
But see, I'm thinking about the trio.
That's somebody little sister.
It's a fourth one. It's always maybe a fourth one that came with them, though. That drove her a little Monte Carlo on her own.
With beats.
That came on her by herself.
Yo, that's a wheelman or a happy go job.
No, the henchmen's going to always pick up the scraps.
No, I feel. Okay, so in a traditional way to attack this situation, I say yes. But if you want to shake it up, like I'm talking about, like, dog. You can't you shake win
it,
big.
It depends on the crew. Some crews you can't shake it up.
I made it from 2003, 2010 doing this.
Some crews are like the Alamo. They pretty solid.
The Alamo.
Shit.
You can get it. Hey. Or you're going to put in a full frontal
assault. Hey, I was rolling with the court.
You put a full frontal assault on, yeah, you can win.
I'm telling you. Full frontal assault's only needed when you have like a 7 to 8 woman group and you need
them. And they're not all tight.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, but you can do that then. That's when the henchman can be
miracles happen every Thanksgiving. And everybody ate. You send a henchman in just to like, yo, you a henchman. You got to jump on this bot. You got to be the fucking idiot. Okay. So you're the
you
idiot.
You gotta tell him that. You be like, yo, hey,
go you do
see?
You.
No. He's like, you see them girls with that? Oh no, dad, I'm on it.
You go talk to the superstar.
Hold on, before we get into those dynamics, I want to know the positions though of the female crew, of the lady.
So it's a superstar, right?
So there's a superstar. There's a hook in this. There's a superstar, and then there's the wannabe superstar.
Yes,
that's dangerous.
Every crew, bro. Yes.
Why am I like thinking of names?
It's like Sith lords. It's like Sith lords. Is the Sith go? If anybody knows anything about Jedi or the Star Wars thing, though, the understudy of the Sith is always trying to take over the other Sith lord spot.
It's
so it's constantly it's
a vice superstar.
It's a constant like okay. I'm literally here just to figure out a spot to take your spot.
Yeah.
And the other one's trying to replace you with somebody else
to be your
apprentice.
That's so crazy. there's a vice superstar.
Yeah, vice.
There's a utility woman because there's plenty of utility women that are out there too.
That's who I like to build with.
Right. For sure.
We make the things happen.
For sure.
Utility woman and dog.
There's a hench woman. However, the hench woman is a little different than the henchman for guys. Because the henchwoman is the left tackle. She's there to keep you off of them.
Yes.
You got it.
If the henchman can get in and penetrate, you good.
Yeah. Well, yeah. If you can put your henchman against your henchman.
If you can have the negotiator lower his standards just a little bit and give her a compliment.
Negotiators are a little vain, though, the lower they stand.
Because they think they're the superstar, too. Fuck. They want to be the superstar.
I got you. But, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, so at jobs nowadays, it's like a cross-matrix training.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everybody kind of got to know how to do everybody's shit, but you still have your position.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And which I think basically all the same.
It's an agile
workplace.
Sometimes
you got to add a little pepper.
Mm-hmm.
You got to because you have women that already see your whole formation.
Now, this is the next level.
See, she's shaking her head, yes.
I got a wrinkle at that.
Well, they've heard about it.
Though, with it. Mm-hmm. The next level of, I think the superstar women convert into a different position faster than men do that are superstars.
They get picked off.
Not necessarily picked off. I'm talking about there's
more superstar women from between 2005
mm-hmm.
and now are married, gone, and moved.
I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Superstar men.
Yeah.
100%.
Superstar men can easily run into they have a Kareem-like career and be still scoring double digits close to 40.
Damn, that's a superstar. No. Mm. Yeah, no, you're right.
I would say 95% of superstar women have gotten picked off and got taken out the game. That's not staying out there for that long. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
I mean, some henchmen will grab them and just defy the laws of gravity.
What happens when a superstar woman comes back into the game, though?
Well, see, now that's the part of my career I'm just starting to see people get.
That's happened. Hey, we on the same page.
Wow.
Hey, 2019 was the year of divorces. Real talk.
I'm talking about. Not necessarily the day she's lingering. What happens when the superstar comes back into the game, though?
Ugh. You want to... I mean, I can...
Come on, AI.
I've seen, like, three situations in 19 alone, like... Yeah. And
look, don't get it twisted, though. That superstar woman going to get back in the game, though, officially.
She's going to get back in the game.
Oh, but she's going to be straight.
But it's a new era, though,
she's been gone.
Depending on how long she's been gone.
gone.
Yeah, she's been
and
gone.
She's really been gone, though. She is a superstar.
It's nah, she was gone, bro.
It's no, no, no. Little... Sometimes they always keep their foot in the pond.
It's a little easier they know, for a superstar they got woman
fucked up. No, no, no. It guy. Is. Yeah. But they always keep know the temperature. Yeah. That superstar still know the temperature.
I'm not going to say... I'm going to say... How can I put this? They know where to be to make it pop again. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? They know where to be to... Okay.
They're not lost.
Who has more demand when they return to the field, though?
Women. I'm going to go with women.
Really?
Yeah. Mm. Because...
And, I think only women superstars do.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to say that because...
Only women
superstars. Okay, so we know by the numbers there's more women than men.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if we're talking about, you know, and we know somebody in common probably, yeah. that if we're talking about like a successful, you know, black woman, the ratio here of successful black men is a lot lower.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what I'm saying? They got every dude shooting at them because every dude know where they came from. Mm. It's going to be more difficult for us because we are getting older now. So... Women ain't gonna be. They gonna be like, girl, he was doing that in 2007. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not really tripping. Ooh, whereas these women have they married and went off for a reason. You know what I'm saying?
Women's mm-hmm. memories are longer than ours. We will have things that we did very long times ago held against us. Even though we moved out of versions of that long ago.
Yeah,
there's people that don't like me for things I wouldn't even know how to do now.
Like, still dislike me. Lady, though, Ian, so how big is your crew though? How big is your crew?
It's complicated.
Sound like a utility woman. She's able to.
I'm gonna let her have this one.
It's complicated because we have like a central group, then like a semi-central group, and then we have some extensions.
See,
but there's See? All it's all love though for yeah. sure. And it depends. I would say
on the event and what y'all doing.
Kinda. I think it would depend really what I've seen over the past couple of years. We're a little younger. Just where people are in their life. Mm. And so for the past year, we had a little crew, and there was four of us. Although there are still other people in the crew who still have like tight relationships and stuff like that. But there was four of us that like kind of ran together and was like going out together and stuff like that. So in that sense, four. But then there's times where we all get together and there's like seven. Mm. You know what I mean?
Magnificent Seven.
That's a pretty good. That's a pretty big.
Question. So I'm going to propose the question to everybody, mm-hmm. but I know she can answer it.
Mm-hmm.
Just something to think about. So one of the things I would say when it comes to guys and it comes to the score, right? The mm-hmm. score, rather it's just getting the world
is it right now. What time is it where we're making this play? What time in the game?
12:30, 1 o'clock.
No, no, no. He said,
because I was like, oh, it's 11:20.
No, no. I said, what time?
No, this is the after midnight before 2 a.m. run.
Okay, that's a.
I give it 1 o'clock here.
Okay,
I give it 1 o'clock.
Here. What time is the spot close? Let's figure this out. Where we're at. What time
is this is important.
Okay, let me make it more realistic to me. It's midnight and the party's over at 1:30.
All right.
Okay.
Oh. Okay. Well, that's kind of like track land time right there.
Yeah, some of my favorite times. That's when you got to be clutch.
Yeah,
just depending on what you do.
That 3 o'clock can get real, real greasy.
Yeah, remember we talked about the 3 o'clock was gonna die. You had some like that. You don't need too much
there.
Trouble.
You don't need to be there by then. If that's gonna happen,
yeah. told me like, yo, get up out of
there. Like I ain't doing nothing to three, man. But so the thing is with guys, like if the score is to like take a sister, whatever, the IHOP. Or get the number, whatever you're trying to do.
That's a crew move, too. Yeah. It can be both things.
Yeah. But see, guys are just kind of like, okay, boom. Okay, the henchman actually, he on point. So today he take, he got the medal or the superstar or whatever. And see, this could get very intricate. But with men, we kind of like, okay, boom, it is what it is. It's not going to be the superstar to say, okay, utility man, it's okay to kick it with her or whatever like that. But with women, and I've seen this, homegirls will approve one of their homegirls mm-hmm. kicking it with somebody or going
or
ahead.
Hate.
So what's the position? I think that's the utility woman who would do that though.
No. Maybe
the approver. Ooh, maybe that's a new one.
Is that even?
Because I don't think it's the superstar.
There's a woman that's in every group. It's like the Secretary of State. The one that's gonna make the execution, who's gonna be the one that you're gonna have. If you don't win her over,
yeah,
none of your efforts are gonna go anywhere.
That means that how good is your negotiator slash your utility man? Because either one of them can kind of.
And also, it also comes down to what, which combinations of crews pair up most often. Because usually you don't want two superstars to get together. That shit's not going to work.
No. Oh, no. That's a club fight.
That's a bad situation.
Lace fronts flying.
Yeah.
Edge control.
No. I'm talking about the dude superstar and the girl superstar. You don't want them getting together.
Oh, it's just that who's the prettiest?
Yeah, that's going
to
be...
We tried to
who's
do that.
The highest?
That's going to be a headache.
Why y'all shouldn't be together? They'd be like, well, they be extra. They'd be like, well, y'all both extra. So, yeah, like, extra. Yeah. Right. Why y'all ain't together?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think a lot of women in girl groups play different roles. Like, I know in our friend group, we have an expectation of each other to hold each other accountable.
Okay.
Mm. So that doesn't necessarily go to one person.
We don't have that at all.
Nope.
No, not at all.
There's no collective.
That's what the chaplain, and the chaplain don't
come out
all the time.
You can't do that tonight,
bro.
Come on.
That's the problem. The chaplain never come out all the time.
Yeah.
Chaplain pops out all the time. That's the one that does that.
The chaplain, the one that got married year after undergrad.
Or he wants to be married for a long time.
There, but that's like,
bro, you ain't even been on the streets, man.
Yeah, you don't even know what the asphalt. You know, but what happens when? Okay, you have the superstar sister, you have the utility sister.
I think,
and it's both a guy.
No, I think it's only. I think the only way it can work is that the superstar has to go down. For who they gonna be with though?
Yeah, but sometimes
only superstar utility.
But so it's never a situation
superstar
where
superstar utility is only gonna work.
But it's never a situation where a guy comes up or and it. Well, hold on. It might be a situation where it's a guy and a superstar like him and a utility like him. Because everybody, even though it's a crew, 100%. You're serving the crew. You still have self interest.
It comes down to the golden rule at the end of that thing. The golden rule always is let her choose.
Yep.
Don't force the play. Let her choose.
And more guys need to understand that.
Yeah, let her choose. That's the goal.
Let her choose.
At the end of the day. Don't try to force the issue, because then you double down on your homeboy too. Yeah.
I've been in
every situation. No, I'm saying, but if it's a situation, so if it's both girls that like this one guy.
Yes. That's a
You gotta let the girls
go. I don't even know how that goes.
Yeah, I'm saying
two girls like one guy.
Cause I wish we would let the girl choose when it comes to me.
I don't know how that goes in the women's.
That's why that was what I was posting.
Oh, you go on the other side of it.
Yeah,
I can tell you.
You gotta let the lady choose.
I can tell you how
man.
I think it happens.
When it
how
comes
do you
to
think
the
it happens?
What I think ends up happening is it ends up being a long petty ass beef over some dude that ain't worth it.
Right.
That ain't worth it.
Two pump chump.
It's like, listen, I'll tell you in a second. Don't argue with my superstar. That nigga is not worth it. No. Don't do it.
My superstar is pretty dope though.
He's grown into being a different thing now.
That's true.
Yes.
If it's who, dope, though.
Me and him talked last weekend, and
yeah,
I was like, you know what, like, you're
dope,
a totally different type of guy now, man. This is fascinating.
I'm
going to
give him a gold star.
Yeah,
I know who he is. But anyway.
The superstar, his crew met the superstar of my crew. It was like when...
No, it was literally like they had to stare at each other like, yo, I don't know who the fuck you are.
It was like,
are you here?
It was like two mimes in the mirror.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. They sat there and they dapped each other. Okay, cool.
It was like...
You work this side of the party, I work this side.
It looked like Ken fighting Ryu.
That's crazy.
Yeah, 100% what it was. That's exactly what it was.
Because I know your superstar.
Yeah.
My guy's out of Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah.
But Adrian's from Chicago too. So
yeah, Adrian's from
My guy's my guy BG. He lived
you
here.
Met, you met him before though.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, I probably have said yeah.
You met him before.
Yeah.
Dude, no, I'm just saying. So go
with
to
the
women.
So,
so
to
women
answer your question,
and one guy, they both after one guy.
There would never, at least in my friend group, there would never be a situation where we're both after one guy.
Because women don't pursue. That's the difference in what we're talking about here.
And then it's just, if there's a situation where multiple people are like, oh yeah, he fine, somebody's going to be like, well, I'm going after him or whatever. And then that usually just is what it is, and we all just follow suit.
Oh, you just opened up a whole nother thing.
Oh,
that sounds like picking teams on the playground.
But it's going to have to be a part two, man.
Well,
yeah,
we usually, like... And so, also, I think another dynamic here is, like, especially with the superstar thing, what happens if you have a group of all, like, pretty attractive women?
Because they all have
different personalities.
Yeah, it's all personalities. Yep.
But then, like, to your superstar point, though, like, who's the superstar? Because... I feel like my group, there's everyone has a really strong personality. And at any point, at any night, like somebody could be the superstar getting all the attention or all the dudes. And
I guarantee we better figure it out. Very fast. Yeah. Maybe 5-10 minutes.
I would love to. Like, this is like a show social experiment. I'm so down for it. Who they are in 5-10 minutes.
Next time you get your whole crew together, let us know.
I can show y'all a picture right now. Y'all be like, yeah.
Yeah, no. It's like the secret shopper. You know, like the secret shopper, you just come in like, hey, you know, like you just talk to everybody like, okay, I know.
I already know who you're
talking about. My fiance's crew is a fairly up and down attractive crew. Mm-hmm. Throughout the whole thing, but they all have different personalities, and they all—I know the role that each one of them plays. Like my fiance is a utility boy, and I'm a utility man, and that makes sense. That works off more.
But a superstar only can dig down, though. That's the problem, though, with them.
And they all feel it too.
Well, you're gonna accept that at some point, though.
Damn,
they can never be with who they are.
The best relationship for a superstar man to end up in is in with that Secretary of State of a woman crew, because she's going to keep his ass.
It's around. Balance. Yeah, it's a fucking balance.
Does it keep them?
Yes.
Secretary of State. But for a guy superstar, what is his best?
Both the Secretary of State.
No, so for a woman.
Oh.
Probably, I would say a henchman if she needs security.
Henchmen are a utility, though.
Henchmen,
I would go with those.
Or happy to be here to be spending that cash.
That's true. Right. But so that's only so long, though.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead, sister.
I was just going to ask Alan, what role does he think I play?
Whoa! This is a setup, bro. I'm trying to bring in 2020 right.
Baby, you're kind of like the third wheel.
We got to do that when we all have our own accomplices here.
Yeah. We should do that. We should definitely do that.
Apparently, I'm a...
So you're not getting to the
habitual
question.
Relationship dodger, no. So I won't have
it. I spent 15 years doing that, bro.
It don't even be me, though. You know what I'm saying? But no, I'm
superstars,
sorry.
Man, and utility.
Hey, man.
But what did AI say, though?
He's declining to answer the question.
So I'll answer the question. Your friends are going to hear this, and they're going to be pissed off at me. But
dude, would you like to still plead the fifth? We do all.
Dude, this is commentary. Intellectual conversation.
And make sure you subscribe to commentary.
Commentary.
This will continue.
So I'll be 100. Yeah. Like, so
please, let's continue.
My lady is a superstar, her crew, but everybody's on their heels for that spot. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. I disagree.
Oh, so basically, she has a Sith Lord situation.
She can play in between those roles. You know what I'm saying? But if I'm being real, and this is my complete observation, you know, like my lady, she just came back from the Shy, so she's only been here for a couple of months now. And the dynamic of her in St. Louis and in Chicago is completely different because Chicago is ground zero. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And
so,
they're not
so
gonna.
So she more superstar in STL more than there.
Well, St. Louis, she.
Or she more laid back.
Ooh, man, this is rough.
Have you had enough time to develop a suited crew?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you have a crew in both cities.
I don't have a crew.
She doesn't have a crew here. Mm-mm. Chi-Town crew is I mean, they thick, and you know, they've been thick for a long time.
Hyde Park got some girls though, man. Hyde Park got a different type of girls though, man.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, boy. Anyway.
You know about the Hyde
Park girls. I think that, you know, from what I've seen, and it's just purely from what I've seen, I know that we can keep 100. She's not gonna be her authentic self when I'm around.
Well, we would hope.
You know what I'm saying? Really? Yeah, oh, absolutely, right? We would hope not. No, and that's not a bad thing.
I mean,
it's not a bad thing. I'm just going to say, you know, like we were long distance for a while.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if we're being real about it, we need to have a long distance podcast. But anyway.
So you're from the 50s?
Nah.
Ooh, I love this shit.
I'm someone else from that high part. You from the 50s?
Welcome back.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. She from the 50s?
Yeah. She over in the thick.
So my best friend from college is your state rep.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Nice.
Crazy.
Shout out to my second crew from college, who is my other superstar.
My crew is a layover crew.
So I have a superstar from my crew.
I'm the Mandalorian.
I have two superstars. That's my other superstar is the one that's the state rep.
I'm really, you know what? Oh, my bad. I mean, cut you off. Now that I think about it, I'm gonna have to go back on it because some stuff just played through my mind.
Dude,
and I was like, wait a minute.
This is kind of your interactions are on how your personality is.
So can I propose something?
Mm-hmm. My lady might be the utility woman.
That's what I was going to say. So, I'm a utility woman.
Yeah. So two things. I asked the guy fathers, Daryl and Matt, that when we do, when we come back with the commentary show, if it's some way that we all can just be on the commentary show and have continue this conversation.
Let's carry it over. We'll make it a second one.
Because for some reason,
we'll do the first episode of y'all show continuing.
Yeah, because I just feel like this is, I think you all are going to get a lot of feedback from this. You can really just probably cut everything out except this part. You know what I'm saying? That's number one. And then number two, man, I just think the strongest, I'm playing it out in my head like a movie, and it just seems like the utility folks are probably, it's like even all of us can meet up, we can leave our crews and all meet up together
but technically,
and have a secret society.
I disagree with Matt when it comes to when he was saying, like, you're talking about the mafia.
Mm-hmm.
The utility guy is the consigliere. Because he's the glue. Consigliere, if you're talking about the mafia, is the glue. He's the one that basically is supposed to be like the glue between the henchmen in the streets and what's going on with that and what's going on with the hierarchy.
Yeah.
The underboss is more of a negotiator.
No, that's the utility man, because this consigliere is the one that's meeting with the senators and meeting with the legitimate side of it.
No. Consigliere also is the one that's, that if you have a grievance within the family, you have to go to consigliere.
Well, exactly. But if you want to get an introduction, you got to go to the consigliere too. You can't go to the underboss and say, I want to speak to the Don.
Exactly. But that's what I'm saying, though. The negotiator is the one that negotiating all this stuff going on within the family, is what I'm saying, though.
Right.
The utility is more of a consigliere than he is an underboss.
Well, we're talking about killers right now, too, which is a little bit of a different...
But they shouldn't be killers, though, in general. So
is it true that the happy-go-lucky person would probably try to appeal to the negotiator the most? Because the negotiator may actually be the person who can get them in.
They would go
or
to
would
the
be the utility.
They go to the superstar.
To the superstar.
Yeah.
But wouldn't that be based off of vein versus political?
No,
I guess
it'd be a woman.
No,
it'd be a woman because he's the capo. Capo's the one that's in the hood, though. He's like, yo, this is what we doing, blah, blah, blah.
In my
you can have more access to him.
The happy to be here person has gone to the superstar because it looks better for them to be associated with the superstar.
Yeah, I can see that for vain reasons. Like, how
but
it saying, looks.
How do you get
but I'm saying, thing? Like, political. Like, who's the one who's saying, okay, man.
It's
like,
if we
the guys and we meeting up and we having a conversation, who's saying, like, okay, we bringing them in?
It's the will man. It's the woman is the one you talk to first.
Okay. But who makes the final call? Because to me, it would either be the negotiator or the utility person.
Because
a superstar, to me, is just too busy kind of...
Yeah. Not paying attention to
it. It's one of them It's a negotiator all the
time. Superstar's too busy playing in traffic.
So it's safe to say that if your utility man leaves your crew could fall apart.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Many of your crew's falling apart because the utility man got a job in another city or something.
Mm.
That's real. Yeah. Because that was the person that was in between everybody. Made those decisions. Superstar was just, you know, he wasn't happy to be there, but Superstar was just, like you said, playing in traffic.
Right.
And then one day you look up, you're like, damn.
So I'm getting ready to say something that's real.
But
real,
this thing though, people don't get it twisted though. The superstar is very vitalized, way more than anything. He's the fucking boss. He's the one that is the front man that makes everything click.
Okay.
Because sometimes people can, like, talk about it like it ain't worth nothing.
Yeah, no.
That fucking position is fucking a heavy position.
The superstar of my current crew is the spine of a lot of activity coming together.
And he also will be like, yo, we know how to get together, though, and blah, blah, blah. And he will bring stuff together, too. So don't get it twisted. The superstar is very much intricate as well.
I've seen situations, though, definitely. But I've seen situations where the utility, how could I say? When it comes to women, so we're talking about the men crews, where you have women who may go for the look, but the for serious woman or for serious women go for what they may deem as the power. And I will say that women are very observant, and I've seen superstars just turn into other things that we ain't even labeled in this because it was the utility man or even the negotiator that appealed.
Because
more
power.
Because the superstar, even though it's power, I'm bringing this together, I'm this, and that. It's just like it still may have seemed paper thin where the utility people kind of standing back and they moving and grooving. And women are attracted to power.
But if a superstar is about his wits, he's going to have enough power to be able to counteract that idea of that power.
Yeah, but one may be natural, one may be forced.
Yep. Yep.
I can agree with that.
I was going to get one on that. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
I'm just, would you like to speak to that? Or if you have a guy who's kind of like the superstar, like, yeah, you know, I got a curl box and I got this and I'm popping and this, that, and the third. And you see, Lil Kim even said the shit. What was it in? I got a crush on you. I like your man style, but I love your profile.
Yeah.
I think that can go, you know, it's a yin and yang thing.
I generally never like the dude who is too extra or. Maybe, I don't know. I generally like more of the chill guy, which is funny because Alan's not. He actually is very chill, but he can turn it on and turn it off.
Utility man.
Yeah.
But I see superstar too, though.
That's stage presence.
Yeah.
But so I generally never like that guy because they're extra. They're probably annoying. And generally, if you, you know, you have any sort of common sense, you know it's a front. So
that's how I feel about the superstar girl.
Exactly, bro.
But at the same time, the superstar girl, though, can be something you don't even know about, though. On some crazy. It's weird because maybe and you can say this with and correct me on it. But I know some superstar women that are like super dope. But you ain't able to get in, though. Because you ain't got in the right position to be able to get in.
Are we by position, are we saying money?
Like finance? That's
a different dynamic.
No. Okay. Within a crew, I think what's presented in front of them at the first time they meet you is what they is, what you are to most women.
I think that, personal observation, I think that, this just me, I think that a lot of superstar women are generally the most insecure, fragile joints out of the crew. I generally think that we all know a lot of superstar women, like, it's just me personally, like, I those are the ones that they have the Instagram following and you know, just have the city on fire and are out here popping. I use Instagram very, you know, loosely.
But see, you're going bigger style with that. I'm talking, there could be three woman crews though that have nothing to do with the Instagram situation.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Superstar within that three woman crew.
Yeah.
Right.
You're looking at more macro. I'm looking at more micro.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm saying, though. Like, maybe they got to play the position, though, because this crew ain't going to move forward if we all utility.
What is a superstar woman? How do you know?
Oh, you know.
Yeah, you know when you see her.
But what is it, though?
She's the peacock of the crew.
Oh, you know.
She's the peacock of the crew.
You know.
Actually,
you know what? Honestly, the way you get a superstar woman, though, you may got to get them by themselves.
You got to ignore the hell out of them.
No, you got to get them by themselves. You cannot get a superstar woman within a crew.
Never speak to them first.
You never can get a superstar woman within a crew.
The last time I spoke to a superstar woman, I think it might have been an event I saw you at.
You can
at
do them by themselves, though, but you cannot
cigar thing.
Yeah.
It was like a cigar. I think we saw each other briefly. I want to say... And it was a superstar woman. I won't say her name. I'll definitely tell you her name when we get off the air. But I think it fucked her up because, you know, if I'm supreme utility man, right? Mm-hmm. I wasn't even speaking to her on the tip of trying to holler. I was just generally saying, like, hey, you know, what's up? And it was like she was stuck in time, kind of like,
you know,
trying to holler. You must be trying to holler.
Yeah. Then I was like, well, you know, it's good. Speak to you. Take it easy.
I've got most of my superstars with that tactic.
I wasn't even trying to. Next thing you know, on my Instagram, it was just like shit's being liked and shit's being responded to. And I'm like, sister.
I've got most of my superstar tactic, bro.
But you still haven't defined the superstar woman, though.
Daryl.
I think that's really about her presence and how she rocks herself, though.
So just like a strong presence?
No.
Can I
it's,
take
it's,
that?
It's, I think it's the one that everybody in the crew looks to for the decisions.
I would say that.
I think women is different with that. Okay, I'll put it like this. I won't say that. But they're the one that be like, they'll call her, be like, what you wearing? I think that's the superstar that be like, what you wearing tonight?
To me, in my experience in watching this, both from interactions with women that I've been with and just ones that knows that they're more or less checking all of that to make sure that it's in reverse for them. They don't make decisions. They kind of go along, but then when they get out there, then they're the ones that are playing like they're in the lead at that point. Mm-hmm. Where they're the ones that are
taking the shots, if you will. Let's use basketball analogy. So mm-hmm. they're the ones that are taking the shots. The Kobe Bryant, like, hey, the ball about to stop when we pass it that way. Type.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But they, behind the scenes, oh, girl, what are you doing? You know, yeah. I want to make, what time are you getting there? What time are you doing this? We ride together. What are we going to do? That type of stuff.
Well, no, that's when the superstar was on.
But that's what I'm saying. The superstar is the one who's asking other people that, not the other way around. In every experience I've ever had in my life, that's always been.
I think the superstar, the people call them like, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. Are you coming? What are you doing?
I think it goes
the superstar
way.
Just shows up.
No. That's what I'm saying. I think people call it superstar. See, what they're, if they don't come, what are they wearing? What are you wearing?
That ain't been my experience.
I guess to answer your question, I think that, like I said, the peacock effect, the superstar, the lady crew is, she has her presence is very strong. Mm-hmm. Like, I think that she has a very strong public personality, mm-hmm. but is very weak in the crew. Like, mm-hmm. y'all like, yeah, everybody likes her, da da da. But that bitch ain't XYZ. Right. Like, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Like,
but is that something that she don't know, though? The superstars don't know that is going on.
Superstars very rarely know that they're superstars because they just are worried about doing whatever they want to do for themselves.
Ooh. Mm. Hey, yo. That was a gem. We might have to wrap it up.
Yeah, I think, like,
that's, hey, we can do that part
too,
man.
Yeah. We're going to do it with the commentary. We coming back, though, at the beginning of this year, though. Brothers, let everybody know. Look at Rashad.
This has been like a fucking great, like, literally, you not telling y'all how to do y'all thing, but I don't know how long we've been going, but you can, like, slice this where you got, like, the introduction, us talking shit, and then cut out all that Bill Cosby, R. Kelly shit and just go straight to this, man, because this is, like, dude, this is fucking groundbreaking what you brothers have put together with this crew.
Yeah, real talk.
Because this has been existing for a very long time, and nobody, I would say the closest I've ever heard is when me, Clem, and Daryl used to have conversations years ago. And we wasn't using any of these terms. No. It was just, we were just naming backstreets.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And for the reasons
locus.
We were naming.
Swiss locus.
Yeah, so this, right.
All right, man. When we come on y'all's, man, y'all can open up with the business y'all need to. Then we can finish up with this too, because we've got no shortage of theories. We've got plenty of theories.
I can't wait to hear the feedback from this, man, because this is like. Yeah, so I'm Rashad. Huh?
It's gonna be great.
Oh yeah. So I'm Rashadism, RHASHADISM at everything, and I'm the utility man supreme.
Yeah. Hit me up on IG at DJ Allen IALLENEYE. My Twitter is DJAEYE, DJAI. If you are rocking with me on the book, you know I'm Allen I there. Otherwise, you can get at me. That's it, really. So.
Did your lady want to?
Lady, want to jump in?
This is Maria. I'm Alan's girlfriend. I'm not really a social media person.
That's fine. You ain't got to.
So I'm not going to share my information. Fine. But it's been a great conversation.
I'm not a social media person either. I just be hanging up. I'm on Twitter. Cheap seat fan. I got a blue check mark that still isn't cashing green checks. No, it does. That's true.
I'm working toward a blue check now.
You can have mine if you want to.
Yeah, I'm working toward it.
You can have it.
Yeah.
No, it's good. It actually does help. It's a good thing to get.
Of course it does. It's because it's a good marketing.
Yeah, I'm probably going to register for mine this spring. So.
Yeah, well, thank y'all for listening. This is a dope episode, though, y'all. We started the year with a bang. Commentary, we're going to finish this out.
We're going to finish this out on the commentary, man.
Yeah, so maybe
We've been telling y'all for months.
Should we do the women thing on the commentary, though? Like, bring the women under for the commentary to let them.
Whatever AI want to do, he boss. I'm just.
I'm not saying we'll like it's all women episode though. No, I'm saying all women episode.
Oh no, they're getting. I'm cool. We can do the all women episode on ours. That's true. We gotta let them get their foot going, and then we'll.
It's gonna be a great night. We'll be in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, well, thank y'all for coming through though, man. It's gonna be dope, man.
Hey, yo, next week, man, we got the OJs for you next week.
Oh my God,
they coming next week.
Yeah, we missed everything tonight.
It's all good. It's all good. No, it's all good. The rentals, they're coming. Man. Best of the 2019s and on up. Though, shout out to OJ, who's one of our favorite people in the world. We love him. And thank you for listening. As always, we'll be back next week. Thank you. Peace.